best NASCAR has to offer in a nail-biting do-or-die race to make the Daytona 500. Let's go to Chris Devoto.
This Sunday, it's NASCAR Super Bowl, but to win racing's greatest prize, you must first put yourself in the race. The field for the Daytona 500 will be set with today's Gatorade Duel. The anticipation is building. Let's head trackside for today's opening ceremonies.
Ladies and gentlemen, please rise and remove your hats as the Daytona Beach Police Department Honor Guard presents our nation's colors. Please remain standing as Dr. Timothy McNeil of First United Methodist Church of Ormond Beach offers today's invocation.
Let us pray. Our God, we give thanks for this, the land of the free and the home of the brave. We give thanks for this new season of man-made lightning and thunder. We give thanks for these gladiators of speed. Keep them in the zone that they may be wise, clear, and focused. Thank you for seas to shining seas. God bless America and Haiti and Afghanistan, and bring hope and healing and peace to your world. Shalom and amen.
Here to perform our national anthem, please welcome Orlando, Florida's own Katina Mack.
Oh, say can you see by the dawn's early light what so proudly we hailed at the twilight's last gleaming, whose broad stripes and bright stars through the perilous fight o'er the ramparts we watched were so gallantly streaming, and the rockets' red glare, the bombs bursting in air, gave proof through the night that our flag was still there. Oh, say does that star-spangled banner yet wave o'er the land of the free and the home of the
is on the pole for the Daytona 500. His teammate Dale Earnhardt Jr., determined to get back to his winning ways, is alongside those two, Mark and Dale, the only ones who know where they will start on Sunday. Others, like Michael Waltrip, doesn't even know if he'll be in the race. Determination and destiny await the drivers in the Gatorade Duel next on Speed. Welcome back to Speed's presentation of the Gatorade Duel. A crisp day in Daytona. I know it's nothing compared to what folks in the Mid-Atlantic are dealing with. Unseasonably cooler here, though, and we're glad all of you are with us today. This is where it all starts and ends, including for some the chance to race in the Daytona 500. Along with our champion crew chief Jeff Hammond, I'm Chris Devoto. And Jeff, this truly is racing's most dramatic afternoon. The winner, not just the guy who will be standing in victory lane.
No, you're right about that. The guys who qualify for this race will be equally as excited as the winners who go into victory lane after each one of these duels. The thing is right now, though, when you think about the way this field is kind of shaping up, you take a look at Mark Martin. He's never won the 500 here on the pole, but right over our shoulder, you can see a glimpse of the 48 car.
It looks nice.
It looks great because it's a brand new backup car. He has to go to a backup car after an incident yesterday. But when you go deeper in the field, either one of these races, there's so much at stake for guys like Tony Stewart. He's never won the 500 either. But when you think about Michael Waltrip, yeah, Max Pappas, Reed Sorensen, Mike Bliss, these guys are dangerous.
Why?
Because they've got nothing to lose, and they're going to be going at it nice and hard. And the key thing is, you don't want to get caught up in one of these guys that's trying to race his way in when you know you're already locked in the top 35. You know you're going to be racing in the 500, but there's only a few positions left. and everything goes right now. Strategy, all different types of agendas that's going to be going on out there. But the electricity, can you feel it right now?
Well, look at where we're standing. I mean, we are down at the front of the grid. Like you mentioned, Mark Martin right behind us. Yep. You hear the air guns going. The crews are getting ready. Who are you getting ready to really keep your eye on today?
Well, in this first race, I'm going to go back to Saturday night's Budweiser Shootout winner, Kevin Harvick. He looked good in practice, real strong in his RCR car. Second race, well, I'm going to be looking at the guy who won here a year ago, Matt Kenseth. He and that Ford are looking pretty sweet. And right now, the key is going to be handling.
Well, and you mentioned the second race. That's right. We have two races. It's the duel. All the guys who are in that second race are watching what the guys behind us are about to do.
A tale of two cities, you might want to say. Well, this case, a tale of two races. The first race may dictate what these guys do in the second.
Well, and nothing will get the adrenaline level in these guys and in us fired up like the firing of the engines. It is time to get this party started. These drivers have been waiting all day, all weekend, for some, all life, for the words you are about to hear.
And now, race fans, it's time for those most famous words in motorsports. Here to give the command, please welcome your Grand Marshal, quarterback of the University of Florida, Tim Tebow.
Drivers, start your engines!
Drivers hoping they are not gator bait today. Names like Carl Edwards, Jeff Gordon, and Kyle Busch racing in Gatorade Duel number one, only on Speed. It's the Gatorade Duel live on Speed from Daytona, the World Center of Racing. Two races today. It's a duel, but we have a triumphant trio upstairs. Darrell Waltrips, Larry McReynolds, and Mike Joy. Gentlemen, are you ready to duel?
Yes, we are. Thanks, Krista. Here is what's at stake today. Mark Martin, Dale Earnhardt Jr. already in the 500, along with the top 35 in last year's car owner points. The two highest finishers in each race today make the 500. Then they'll take the four fastest drivers from pole qualifying. So who is affected? Bill Elliott, Scott Speed. Those drivers in blue could get in on Speed, and if they race their way in, so could any of the next four. But below that line, all of those drivers have only one chance to make the Daytona 500, and that is this race and the one to follow. So, Darrell, a lot of different agendas between the drivers in this race. Maybe that's why this is the most exciting day of Speed Week.
Well, you know, I'd always ask Hammond, what do I got to do? And he said, just pass them all. And so that was always what I felt like. If I pass all of them, I'll be in. But you know what, Mike? This is Daytona. And I don't care if it's practice, I don't care if it's a qualifying race, I don't care what it is. When they drop the green flag here and you're racing to the checkered, that's an important race. Having to go home after all the hard work, testing, and everything you've done getting ready for this race, just go home with something. Go home with a win in a qualifying race, a trophy, a something. That's a successful Speed Weeks down here.
And yet toward the end of this grid, Larry, there are some drivers for whom these are the desperate hours.
And it is, Mike, and it comes at one of the racetracks where you can have everything going perfect, but you control about 0.1% of your destiny. It's so easy to get caught up in someone else's wreck. And the way this format is, you talked about it, only the top two finishers of the go-or-go-homers will transfer. That means you could run in the top 10 in this race and miss the Daytona 500. And I was fortunate enough to come here for 20 Daytona 500s. I never missed a 500. I could not imagine what it feels like to not qualify for the biggest race of the year.
All right, let's have a look at the Gatorade starting grid for duel number one. Todd Bodine replaces Kirk Shelmerdine in the 27, so he'll start out back. And from back to front, here's the way the rest of this field qualified. There will still be a couple of drivers in backup cars headed toward the rear. Clint Bowyer crashed in practice when he cut a tire, got into the wall. Jimmy Johnson also involved in a crash, so they are in backup cars. They will start out back. Now, Golden Corral shows us cars to look to race into the Daytona 500. And one of those, Larry, Reed Sorensen.
Yeah, well, he looked awfully good in that practice session yesterday. This is a team, Brian Racing, full-time Nationwide Series team running a partial schedule. He knows he's got to go or go home.
Also in this race, a two-time Daytona 500 winner trying to race his way into the show.
Let's check in with him and see how he's doing out there. Michael Curtis, it's a DW. You got a copy, buddy?
Loud and clear, DW. How's it going up there in the TV booth? Coming to you live from the Napa Toyota.
Attaboy. Yeah, it's all good up here. Listen, speaking of all good, you're a two-time Daytona 500 winner, but today, bud, you got 60 pretty important laps here to get the job done. Can you do it?
Yeah, I'm very confident, Darrell. The car worked real well. Bobby Kitty, all the MWR guys have brought me a car here that I can not only transfer with, but I think I can get up there and contend. So we won a couple of these Thursday races, and I'd sure like to win another one.
Well, good luck, buddy. Yeah, you're one of the greatest restrictor plate races of all time. Don't forget that.
I won't, and I'm going to remind some people of that here in a minute.
Thanks, Darrell. There is the lineup on the pace laps for Gatorade Duel number one, coming at you live on Speed. In these two races, they can either lock in or they can load up and go home with nothing.
It's a race at Daytona. You want to win it.
Two races, whole lot of faces. To have you with us on Speed for this part of over 130 hours of NASCAR programming on Speed this week. Here's our Hershey's chocolate milk and milkshakes race format. The two highest finishers in each race, not already qualified, that means not in the top 35 in owner points from last year, will be shown on the ticker at the top of your screen in green, and they will make the 500. So they'll either be racing in or on the outside looking in as this race rolls along. Let's get out to our NASCAR on Fox pit crew, beginning with Steve Burns.
Thank you, Mike. Everybody loves an underdog story. Terry Cook has over 300 starts and 6 wins in NASCAR's Camping World Truck Series. So I asked him, why make the move up now? He said, I'm 41 years old. This may be my last chance to race with the elite. I said, do you have any help? He said, there are 7 Dodge teams here, but I'm the only one in this dual race. He does have Joey Logano's pit crew helping out. Matt?
Steve, Max Pappas earned his nickname Mad Max after a legendary performance in the 1996 Rolex 24. But today could be the biggest challenge of his career. He's got to secure one of those 2 transfer spots. They've made great strides with their race car over the week. Well, he says it's going to be elbows up, totally focused on his day of desperation. Dick Bergen.
Perfect. Mark Martin starts on the pole because he turned the fastest lap in time trials. And he will start on the pole of the Daytona 500. But only if he doesn't crash his car in this race to the point of needing a backup. The car unstable in practice yesterday, so they are worried. Martin with 2 jobs today. Try to win the race, but if you can't do that, at least bring it home in one piece.
Thanks, Dick. For the first time in 40 years, a Ford paces the NASCAR Sprint Cup Series at Daytona. The 2011 Ford Mustang GT about to cut low.
Interesting. Mark Martin, the pole sitter, chose to start in the outside line. The pole sitter has that choice.
...150 miles of racing, and we're underway in the first Gatorade Duel.
You know, Larry, he might have decided he can get a better push from the 18 and the 21.
That could have had a lot to do with it, and of course, with these restrictor plate engines, it takes a while to get them wound up.
Remember last Saturday night in the Budweiser shootout, the race was won by Kevin Harvick by starting in the outside lane on the final restart.
Pretty much dead even right now, halfway down the back straightaway, so no advantage either way at this point. 21 is giving Bill Elliott in it. 21 is giving Ryan Newman a pretty good push right there. Folks, you're probably at... in your office right now, probably watching this. And these guys are at work right here in their office today, too.
Who'll lead the first lap, Darrell? It'll be Newman by about a foot.
And by now, Mark Martin's probably saying, maybe I should have stayed on the inside.
Darrell talked to Michael Waltrip in that 51 car. We're riding with Kyle Busch now, the 18, but Michael already starting to make a little noise, riding right behind Kyle Busch.
Denny Hamlin right in the middle between the 24 of Jeff Gordon and A.J. Allmendinger in the 43.
Michael's always had a good handling race car. If this thing goes green for a while, that's always been sort of his advantage here at Daytona.
Look at Joe Nemechek in the 87. That car moving up on the inside. Joe has two ways to make the race. He can race his way in, or his qualifying speed will get him in.
But what we've seen down here, the middle is not a real good place to be. That sucker hole down the middle has not paid off for anybody.
And that's where Michael Waltrip stuck right now. He has Denny Hamlin, the 11, Harvick, the 29 with him, which may be his only saving grace.
And that, when you're in the middle like that, and you got cars on either side of you, you get a little loose one way, you get a little shove the other, you're really getting bounced around by the wake turbulence.
Mark Martin becomes the first driver to pull out with a lead.
And look at this, three wide throw. Ooh, ooh, ooh. Mikey just got a little bump from Joe Nemechek in the 87. Got him loose, but he hung on to it.
Oh,
he's loose again.
Hamlin.
Mikey's had a lot of trouble down here. You know, he spun out in the all-star race, in the shootout race the other night, and spun out in practice yesterday. So he's had his hands full with that car.
Greg Biffle putting a little push on.
It's actually on his teammate, Carl Edwards, in the 99. Those two guys, different race cars, but they both had great race cars in the Budweiser shootout last Saturday night.
And one of the things that's so different this time here at Daytona than what we heard in the past, listen to the engines. These guys can get in and out of the throttle and not lose any positions. Like here in the past, you've had to hold the thing wide open or you just got passed by everybody.
Right now, the two transfer spots, Bill Elliott in the 21, Michael Waltrip in the 51, and Joe Nemechek off the pace.
And I'd say there is a method to his madness. He is locked into the Daytona 500. He's not going to get that race car tore up.
I'll tell you another guy that might want to think about that, too. I just saw Bill Elliott off of turn four there get really, really bad loose. And, of course, Bill is in the race, so
he's running fourth right now.
I think Bill would just like to get some laps here and see how good his car is and what maybe needs to be done to it for Sunday. But he needs to be real careful in that car.
Ooh.
That was Jeff Burton just sliced and diced off the front of Ryan Newman there.
That's all spotter. That's when the spotter says you're clear up now and you got to go right then. You can't hesitate.
Newman snapped right back down to the bottom as they battle for fifth place.
Everybody's car is probably driving decent right now, but what we've seen all weekend long, you get up about 10 or 12 laps on those tires of green flag racing, that's when the handling really starts to become a handful. Allmendinger in that 43 car, he had a good qualifying run and he's backing it up. He drove right up there to the top three, riding right behind Kyle Busch in that 18.
One slow car on the apron will make it back to the garage. Jeff Fuller starting the second Joe Nemechek car. Will not finish this one and we'll head home.
And you can see what kind of happens here at Daytona. We're coming up to six laps. It doesn't take but just a few laps for that really good feel those tires have and the car has to start to deteriorate and go away lap after lap after lap. All of a sudden, you really just want to kind of get in single file and work on them one at a time instead of three or four at a time, getting three wide like we were there a bit ago.
You know, guys, that 31 car of Jeff Burton and Greg Biffle in that 16, Jeff Hammond talked about this in the pre-race, and I thought he was spot on because Richard Childress and the Roush Fenway cars, they maybe didn't have that brute speed for qualifying, but just like in the shootout, looks like their cars are driving good.
Well, both car owners told me that they brought cars here that have a little bit more downforce than that would let them qualify good, but they felt like it would pay off in the race, and so far it has.
Look at them three wide with Jimmy Johnson stuck in the middle between Harvick and the 37 of Travis Quappel, the blue car on the outside.
Yeah, it's Jimmy Johnson's backup car. Started in the rear. Boy, that car moved a little bit through those bumps, so, and we've seen that a lot here. But Jimmy's slowly working his way to the front.
He has wasted no time at all. In fact, he's about to crack the top 10 just after seven laps.
In the transfer spots, Bill Elliott, Michael Waltrip here in the 51. Waltrip is 11th. The next transfer spot, potentially, Michael McDowell is in 20th position in the Prism Motorsports 55.
And you know, two of the best cars in the Bud Shootout the other night, McMurray in the 1 and Harvick in the 29, felt like they would work their way right to the front, but they're kind of stuck mid-pack right now.
Harvick in 14th, McMurray in 13th. Just ahead, driving the number 1 for Earnhardt Ganassi Racing this season. Mark Martin has had it his way ever since the first lap that was led by Ryan Newman. Mark Martin from Kyle Busch, A.J. Allmendinger, Jeff Burton, and Greg Biffle. Speed's presentation of the Gatorade Duel at Daytona is presented by G2. Half the calories, all the G. Brought to you in part by Hershey's Milk and Milkshakes, a new way to indulge in Hershey's. And by Alien vs. Predator, 2010's biggest multi-species, multiplayer event. Completing lap 12, Mark Martin still on point, Kyle Busch, A.J. Allmendinger, and now Michael Waltrip is the leading go-or-go-home car, followed by Bill Elliott and Max Pappas.
I bragged on Michael's setup here. It's usually pretty good, but he's actually been drifting back a little bit, and he's going to be in
outside.
He's going to be in trouble here in a minute if Max Pappas gets up there and gets after him.
Matt?
And DW, he just simply said on the radio, the car is real pushy, real loose, not a very good balance at all.
Yeah, right now, Matt, he just doesn't look fast. Looks like he's moving around on the racetrack, been high, been low, been trying to find some place where the car will handle for him, but they're going to have to adjust on it, I believe.
So Waltrip is 14th. Bill Elliott has slid back to 17th. Max Pappas is 20th, followed by a host of go-or-go-homers.
Now, one thing I don't know that we got to address very much in the pre-race is this is a 60-lap race. These guys will have to make, regardless, one pit stop, whether it's under green or under caution. The fuel window is about 38 to 42 laps.
Now, these cars, they hold the fuel cells somewhere between 18 and 20 gallons. I don't have any idea because depends on who you asked. But they're supposed to be around 18 and a half gallons.
Now, at the top of your screen, Mark Martin, Kyle Busch, those drivers are locked in, so their position has a gray background. The two drivers in the transfer spots right now, Michael Waltrip and Bill Elliott, their position numbers will have a green background, and the rest of the drivers trying to race their way in will be designated yellow. Dick?
Well, Mark Martin in the lead has told his crew that the car is a little bit free. That's good because free is fast, but it's a little difficult to hang on to a free car at these speeds at Daytona, Steve.
Dick, A.J. Allmendinger started 12th up to 3rd, says the car is bottoming out just a little bit and kind of tight in turns 1 and 2 in the center. But other than that, he says the car is pretty good.
Allmendinger showing that his third place finish in last year's rain shortened Daytona 500 was no fluke.
And Mark Martin's got a pretty good race car. You know how I know? Because Kyle Busch don't follow anybody if he doesn't have to.
Good point. Ryan Newman led 2 laps. Mark Martin's been out front for the last 13 now. And Bill Elliott has dropped back to 17th. Steve?
Mike, he's a little confused. He's not understanding the way the car is handling. He says it's shoving the nose up the hill, and I've got her wide open.
And right now, he doesn't have any cars hardly in front of him or behind him. And this is a battle for 7th place. Again, that Jimmy Johnson, that 48 car, the backup car from the rear. He just keeps making his way to the front as he pulls up behind Carl Edwards in the 99, McMurray in the 1.
Yeah, he and McMurray have been working together pretty well. Jimmy Johnson, McMurray there have been working together pretty well and kind of easing up toward the front. I really expect to see that one car up there challenging before the day's over with.
Wait, Carl Edwards with a power move to the bottom.
Yes, sir. That car's handling pretty good. Well, I thought it was until I saw that. I mean, does that tell you? You know, it looks easy. It looks like these cars are just floating around here. But that's how much movement these cars have in them.
The 48.
Watch when he gets in the corner here now.
got Burton alongside to his left.
You see, what is tiring about driving a race car is every muscle in his body is tense. He just gave a wave back, and that's a cool thing to do. But every muscle in your body is tense. That's why right now you see him trying to relax, because when you get in a corner, everything on you is locked up. Your hands, your arms.
And the boundaries here aren't just a line of lime. There's a finite boundary, and Jimmy Johnson found it last lap coming off turn number two. Let's take a look at the 48. Right behind the Aflac car.
Oops. You know what? The safer barrier jots out right there, and he just it closed in on him right there. You can see it.
Sure did.
That's about not quite 3 feet. It's about 30 inches that safer barrier sticks out there.
Yeah. I tell you, this is they found trouble. Jimmy Johnson's found trouble on a number of occasions here. 24-hour race, you know, Larry, he was down here for that race and backed his car into the wall hard here in practice before the race ever started, and in a backup car today, so it's not been a cakewalk by any means.
Among the transfer cars, Michael Waltrip 15th, Bill Elliott 17th, they're in. Max Pappas in 20th, Reed Sorensen, gotta get going. One of 60 laps complete, Mark Martin has led all but two from A.J. Allmendinger and Kyle Busch. Greg Biffle and Jeff Gordon now the front five. But the drama, there's Michael Waltrip. He's the first of the transfer cars. Then two more that are locked into the field. All those drivers will race on Sunday. Here's the drama. Max Pappas, Reed Sorensen, Todd Bodine, all trying to race their way in to the Daytona 500. Matt.
Absolutely.
And Mike, he had his corporate teammate Todd Bodine trying to help him, push him up to the front, but he lost that wingman. Basically, he says the car needs to be much more free. He was trying to tell Todd where he could run the best, but then he lost Todd at lap 17. Meanwhile, Reed Sorensen in that 32 car, his car way too tight, not sucking up as well as it did in practice. Right now, this is where the drama is, trying to get that spot to transfer into the Great American Race.
Both of those drivers are on the outs right now. They need to move past either Bill Elliott or Michael Waltrip to be able to stay for Sunday. Now, Kirk Shelmerdine, the former crew chief for Dale Earnhardt, came down here with this Toyota and qualified it Saturday, then turned the driving chores over to a four-time veteran of the 500, Todd Bodine, who has two wins in the Camping World Truck Series here.
Yeah, it's the last two races we've had here, and I know watching the Truck Series practice, of course, that race will be on speed tomorrow night. He looked like he had one of the best trucks in that practice session.
Yeah, he was real good. He was like second or third, I think, in time.
There's Shelmerdine, who was a pretty impressive driver when he ran in ARCA and finished in top 20 in one Daytona 500.
Jeff Burton, the 31's got problems, and we're probably going to see. Caution is out.
Yeah, he's got a right front tire that's
caution's out.
Let go on him.
Didn't his teammate Clint Bowyer have right. a right front go down in practice and find his way up into the turn two wall and go to a backup car?
One of the things that makes these cars really turn is if you lay the camber to them. And if you do lay the camber to them, then you take a chance on eating a bead up the inside of the tire.
Now he's right in front of his teammate Bowyer right there.
You see this thing probably just take off here.
Yep. Yeah, that tire just exploded.
The camber, when you lean the tire in, it'll make the car turn through the corner, but.
Now, what's interesting about that, let's listen to this. We have had, to my knowledge, one other tire issue here, and it was on a Childers car, Clint Bowyer, yesterday, a right front. Pit road is closed right now. There's no question when they open it, all of them will be there for four tires.
Is that a
Yeah, you know, when you have when one team has issues, you usually can say it's probably not the tire. It might be something that they're doing to the tire.
So here's a look at the go or go homers. Michael Waltrip and Bill Elliott are in the qualified positions right now. Below the line, everyone would go home except Joe Niemicek. He'd be one of the four drivers who could fall back on his qualifying speed in order to make a race.
Well, and Reed Sorensen, unless he can get up there in that top two, they'll have to almost sit and wait and see what happens in the second dual race, Reed in the 32 car.
Well, this is kind of a break for guys that need to work on their cars. You come in right now, we'll be up to almost halfway of this race when they go back to green. You come in now, make a couple of good changes on your car, and you might be able to get back up there and race these guys.
You can be part of the wildest collection of talent ever assembled at Trackside. Singers, dancers, comedians, and more. Coming to a breakthrough racing entertainment hour on the speed stage at the speedways we visit. Fast Track to Fame premieres Monday, March 1st, 9 p.m. here on Speed.
You know, we're speaking of Jeff Burton, and of course, Childress has had, he's used up a few race cars down here. Harvick's had one, and Boyer's had one.
Each team has had problems with one.
Now, pit road is still closed. Safety workers out around the track, so we'll take a break from Daytona. Pit road is open, and here comes almost everybody. John Andretti stays on track. Everyone else comes to pit road. Matt?
Michael Waltrip pulling to a stop in his box. He said, I'm not an engineer, but I can tell you simply the nose has not hit the racetrack the entire race. Way up in the air, they talked about making some different adjustments, but they have not done that yet. Just air pressure. Steve?
Matt, A.J. Allmendinger completely missed his pit box, sailed right through it. The team had to push him back. They're going to take air out of the left side tires and make a chassis adjustment. His car is tight, Dick Berggren.
Mark Martin is pitted in the first box. He came in first. He will leave first. No adjustments. Oh, no. Kyle Busch is beating him out of pit road. No adjustments whatsoever to Mark Martin's car. They're very happy with the way that thing is behaving this afternoon.
And Allmendinger will fall from third to 17th coming off pit road, 18th overall.
It was a complete mess. Let's show you what the product of adrenaline flowing, first stop of the year, speedway brakes. A.J. Allmendinger coming to pit road, comes in running second. He's going to completely slide through his pits. There's his pits coming through, stand by, coming through. Now, they have to push him back into their pit box before they can even start the work. And it just went downhill from there. Again, this is AJ's first stop of the year. He was not in the Budweiser shootout.
And Larry, when we get a chance here, I'm going to show you some of the what causes some of these woes. Look at the pit boxes, and look at the oil, and look at all the stuff that's in those pit boxes. We had a 24-hour race here about 10 days ago, and that's just where they 24-hour cars have spilled oil and gas and rubber and everything else. Those are the slickest pit boxes that we go to all year long.
Speed aerial coverage today is brought to you by DirecTV. DirecTV, it'll change your life. Call 1-800-DIRECTV. Getting ready for the restart. It will be 29 complete, 31 to go.
Yeah, we got Kyle Busch on the outside this time and Mark down on the bottom there. I kind of like the setup, though. You know, with Kyle got the 24, Jeff Gordon behind him. That 99 car of Carl Edwards is bad fast, so that inside might go.
But I believe you're right on Mark Martin. He's choosing the line where he thinks he's got the best pusher
behind
him.
Get the pusher. Yeah, I think so, too. And by the way, I just want to make a comment about pit road. It's a mess. If Sunday, when I know what pit box I got, I'm going to run down to Lowe's or Home Depot and get me a power washer. And I'm going to get in there and I'm going to clean that bad boy up.
Denny Hamlin running in sixth place as of the restart, fifth right now. Steve?
Mike, a little concern in Denny Hamlin's camp. Denny said, I picked up a small vibration and the tone of the motor has changed.
From Hamlin's car, you see Greg Biffle giving Jeff Gordon a push. That's just about the opposite of the way they ended the Budweiser shootout Saturday night. In the transfer spots, Michael Waltrip and Bill Elliott right now. Then it's Terry Cook, Max Pappas, Joe Nemechek.
Well, that little break right there, that caution, could help some of these guys that were back here trying to make it in, because you get a couple of, you know, get adjustment, make a little air pressure change, wedge, turns the car around, you might be able to get up there and race them.
Kyle Busch trying to become the third different leader of this race.
I just believe he got the most help in that outside line by Jeff Gordon in the 24 and then Biffle in the 16 behind Gordon.
And here comes Gordon to the outside.
That's a guy that had a fast car Saturday night in the Bud Shootout, Jeff Gordon. I tell you, I thought he was going to win the thing. Whoa, Kyle almost. Kyle wanted to try to get in between Gordon and Biffle, but he saw that wasn't going to work.
Biffle pushing Gordon down toward turn one and two. We're going to let you enjoy some of the sounds of speed. His way into the 500, the 41-year-old rookie slides to bring out caution number two.
Got some damage on the nose there. Looks like that splitter dug into the grass. I believe he got a little tap.
The only dodge in this 150-mile race. There's Cook's number 46.
Up on the outside there. I think possibly.
Well, Bowyer and Pappas came together.
Yep. Yeah.
Behind him.
In fact, had it not been for Terry Cook, Clint Bowyer would have been in the wall hard after that bump from Max Pappas.
And a bad break for Cook. He went right across one of the drain covers there in the infield. I think it really did a lot of damage to the nose of that car.
And I'm going to tell you what, Terry Cook had worked his way up pretty nicely in that 46 car.
Watch right here, Larry, right there. Hit that drainage cover.
Steve?
And Mike, as we saw, that accident certainly not of Terry Cook's making. But he was saying that he was very light in the rear end of the race car. When anyone got near him, the car wanted to turn right. But Cinderella's story may be coming to an end here at Daytona.
Yeah, I think the glass slipper broke, Steve.
But that was absolutely not his fault at all.
Terry Cook was running 17th at the time of that crash.
Tell you what else I noticed as they went sliding through there, too. Max Pappas is all over the back of Michael right now. They're running right together, and that's a transfer spot.
Pappas in the 13 from Como, Italy. World-class road racer. For more, here's Matt.
And Mikey is going to hit pit road. Cosmetic damage from that incident. He said that it had tire smoke on that left front. Booty Barker calling him to pit road. They're going to change right side tires. They've got a baseball bat. They're going to try to work on that left front fender. Pappas so close to that transfer spot. Like you said, they are not giving up. A lot of race still left here to get that final spot.
Well, he's one of eight cars, Matt, to hit pit road, led by Jamie McMurray and Bill Elliott. The yellow car is Bowyer. That dark, almost black machine is Michael McDowell, the 55.
But what I notice is a lot of those guys that's racing right there in the middle of the field for that transfer spot, like Pappas, like Reed Sorensen, and like Bill Elliott. Of course, Bill is locked into the show.
Laps complete. Repairs continue for Terry Cook. Reed Sorensen also made a pit stop. And a lot of work being done to Clint Bowyer's car. Terry Cook's slide through the grass brings out the caution. Tomorrow, the trucks are back. We're here in Daytona for the clashes, crashes, and high-banked excitement. The Camping World Truck Series season opener. Tomorrow, 7:30 Eastern, and only on Speed. There's the truck garage. They're all getting ready. They practiced earlier today. And the lights are off atop the Ford Mustang GT pace car. And here they come. Greg Biffle has elected the outside lane on Jeff Gordon. Kyle Busch, David Ragan, Mark Martin back in fifth. Ryan Newman, Carl Edwards, and the first go-or-go homers are now Joni Imacek 13th, Michael Waltrip 14th, and Michael McDowell 17th. Top two transfer.
You know, as I say this and people say, duh, but the leader, the guy that's on the pole, whichever side he chooses, restarts the race, and you cannot be ahead of him when you cross the start-finish line here. So that's why you take the side you feel like you got the best shot in, because you're going to go first, and you're going to cross that line first, and that gives you a slight advantage.
The restart comes with 25 laps to go. And NASCAR today in the driver's meeting announced a new procedure for the green-white checker in all three of its major touring divisions. More on that later.
That 16 car is fast, Larry. He drove up here and took the lead from Jeff Gordon there a minute ago, he and Kyle Busch. That 16 is fast, Jeff. Greg Biffle.
We've been talking about it all week long, with the exception of qualifying. The Roush Fenway cars, you see that six car of David Ragan in the outside line behind Biffle. They've got their cars racing good this year.
Yeah, and you know, you got Biffle and you got Edwards and you got Ragan here. That's a potent threesome.
Right of your screen, the 51 Michael Waltrip is the first of the transfer cars. He's in 12th.
Looks like Michael's car runs pretty good on new tires, and then it looks like maybe it fades a tad.
Now he's going to lose that spot to Joe Nemechek. That's not a sponsor on Nemechek's 87. FrontRowJoe.com is his website. He'd love to have you visit there if you'd like to sponsor that car.
You know what, guys, we can talk about fast cars and good handling cars. I think a car that has both qualities, as Michael just slides back up in line, is A.J. Allmendinger in that 43 car. He has worked his way back into the top 10. Remember, on that first caution, just not that many laps ago, eight laps ago, he slid through his pits and restarted in 17th.
And when you do something like that as a driver, you become a man on a mission. You'll get it. You know, I got to get that back. I cost us a shot at winning this thing. Don't worry, guys. I'll get it back.
One big difference between this car and the car in which Allmendinger finished third in last year's 500, they've changed makes. That whole Richard Petty Motorsports team now driving Fords.
Well, this is not necessarily a race where you want to be a man on a mission. You know, your mission here is just to bring it home in one piece. You got the 500 you're looking forward to on Sunday. But I know that's what he's thinking. Been there, done that.
The 32 Reed Sorensen, the 27 Todd Bodine. Right now, Sorensen is in the final transfer spot in that Dollar General number 32. Bodine wants it, and so does the 13 of Max Pappas.
It's a good little race right there, guys. And I tell you, I'm impressed with Todd Bodine getting that 27 car up in the mix. I'm sure that Kurt Schermerdine is pretty impressed himself.
Now, one thing we need to make note, with that pit stop that almost everyone made on lap 27, we had some others pit on lap 33. These guys can go to the end. No more pit stops are needed. If we get a caution, I think you'll see a lot of them back on pit road for four tires, but they can go to the end on fuel.
Yeah, just like in the Budweiser shootout the other night, Larry. I mean, what, there were four or five laps to go. They all came on pit road and got four tires. And we're riding along with Denny Hamlin here, and let's see how he looks. He gets a glance in the mirror as he heads off in the corner, but then you can just see how much all that input and all that vibration and juking on the steering wheel, that's the tires going over the bumps. And you really have to stay on top of that, because the car wants to take off up the hill with you, so you really got to work that wheel to keep it where you want it to go.
Now, Hamlin's back in 14th, Larry. He's about to fall into the clutches of some desperate men if he doesn't get going forward.
And those guys, for the time being, well, about the time I say that, they're not in a single line, but they were lined up nose to tail catching him, because that's when you can run the fastest.
And the other thing about, just stay on Denny here just a second, watch his head bounce up and down. You know, that it almost blurs your vision sometimes when you go through some of the big swales on this racetrack and your head bounces around like that, side to side, as well as up and down from the G-forces. You want to know why a guy has a headache at the end of the day? Well, you got a good idea right there.
Greg Biffle back to the front. He's led five laps today. Mark Martin led 28. Jeff Gordon led five, and Ryan Newman the first two. Newman's worked his way back up to fourth.
And you know, Sorensen right now, the 32 cars, our top go or go home car, that's one of the cars that made another pit stop on that last caution. It's almost like just fresher tires by a few laps, two or three laps, makes a difference.
Whoa, Allmendinger almost got his bell rung by the 27 of Shelmerdine.
Well, Allmendinger is in the 500. Kurt is go or go home, so he's got to go.
And that's, of course, Ty Bodine in Kirk Shelmerdine's car,
Kirk
the 27.
Yeah, and Allmendinger may have thought that was Shelmerdine, and he might have thought, well, he's the owner of that car. He'll let me in, but he doesn't know that Todd Bodine is driving that car, maybe.
Well, Bodine in the 27 is trying to get to the 32 of Reed Sorensen. He's just worked his way past Michael Waltrip, and that puts Bodine in and Waltrip out right now.
Listen, they're racing for $260,000. If you make this race, what you'll make today, minimum of 20 grand out of the qualifier and 240,000 to start the 500, these are men racing hard for a pretty good paycheck.
And see, what all these guys know right now is Joe Nemechek and Bill Elliott, two of the cars that were locked in on speed, that they're back behind them. It doesn't look like right now they're in a position to race their way in, so they would be two cars to use their speed to get in.
No one will need the champions provisional this year because the two drivers eligible for it, Bobby Labonte and Bill Elliott, were among the four fastest qualifiers of those drivers outside the top 35. So that provisional will not come into play.
You know, I don't know what's going on, Larry, with Jeff Gordon on that restart. He was up there fighting for the lead. I've watched him the last couple of laps. He has fallen through the field like they have some kind of problem with that car. What are they saying, Burns?
DW, the most recent thing I have heard from Jeff Gordon is that his car has gotten on late exit. And also want to update Denny Hamlin. I said moments ago, he said the motor had picked up a tone that he didn't like. Now he says it feels like it's down on power, but the gauges are okay.
And Hamlin is in eighth. You see the seven cars in front of him. And Jeff Gordon drops in behind him.
That sounded, a driver really drives by the sound of the engine. It's got a hum to it that you kind of get accustomed to. Man, as you see these guys fan out back here behind the 11 car. But it could be a cracked header. It could be a valve spring. It could be any number of things that'll change the sound of the engine. That's alert to the driver that something's going on.
Michael Waltrip comes back. He dropped low and he passed Todd Bodine. And the final transfer spot switches up once again.
We talked about it at the top of the show that more than likely the transfer spot, they would be racing each other, maybe side by side coming down to the line. But Matt, with about 16 laps to go, what Michael Waltrip, what is he saying?
His car is like night and day, Larry Mack. Before that pit stop, he said the nose was way up in the air. After some adjustments, he says now it's much better and it's planted. Booty Barker, Max Pappas' crew chief, telling him to stay in line. Too many laps left. Be patient before you make your move.
That's a good point, Darrell. 16 laps to go. Isn't that just too many to give it all up right now?
Oh, man, yeah. And I tell you, speaking of too many to go, I don't know if 18 can make that many more or not. Did you see that? I mean, he was out of control.
It's like that six car, David Reagan, was on the outside, and it's just pulling the back of Bush's car around to the outside.
And when you start sawing on it like that, you just can't ever get the car settled back down. You're left, right, left, right, left, right. It washes it right to the wall, and all you can do is get out of the throttle.
So who's up there in third, Mr. Where did he come from? Kevin Harvick has worked his way up into the front trio behind Greg Biffle and David Reagan. 15 laps to go. 11 laps to go in the first of this doubleheader to set the field for the Daytona 500. And right now in the transfer spots, 15th Michael Waltrip, 16th that yellow car is Reed Sorensen. And right behind him, the black car of Todd Bodine, the 27. Max Pappas further back, whose only shot is to race his way in.
Michael to the left of screen up there, and then Sorensen not too far back. But Michael's really getting a good pull off of that pack in front of him. Sorensen's losing ground, and so is Bodine. So those guys need to get back up there if they're going to challenge Michael for that spot.
If you win this race, you earn a second row starting spot for the Daytona 500. And the field fills in back from there based on finishing position.
In as many pit stops as these guys will be making on Sunday, it helps your pit selection because obviously you'll pick your pits for the 500 by how you start the race.
Our leader is Greg Biffle. Dick?
Well, Biffle just said what every crew needs to hear. Just two words, real good. And then a few laps later, he said that he was going to try to run the bottom so the six car, Reagan, would get a little bit more air to his radiator. They think the six is going to continue to follow Biffle all the way to the end of this race and help him win it.
They are teammates at Roush Fenway Racing. Jack Roush, in all the years he's been coming to Daytona, has never won one of these Duel races as a car owner.
You know, Darrell, the one thing that I will challenge that we heard a while ago, the way these cars are driving, the way they're juking around, whether you're racing for the lead, racing for 10th, I don't know if I would want to wait around. You better make your move when you can make it, when it's available.
Oh, yeah, because it's just the way the cars are moving around, bouncing around, that can affect where you want to be as well. So the thing I'm kind of wondering what happened to Carl Edwards. I thought he would be here. You got 16, Biffle and Reagan up here, the two Fords. The 99 just disappeared. Where'd he go, Matt?
DW, before the pit stop, he told Bob Osborne the car just has such a bad push from the center of the corner off. Felt like the right front tire had about 100 pounds of air in it. They made a wedge adjustment and air pressure. He hasn't said anything about the balance since. More concerned about which line he was in. He was stuck on the bottom when the high line was moving. Now he's got himself back up the top. Then he went to the bottom, then back up top again.
Wow, that's what I'm saying. He's just kind of searching for somewhere where the car, if it's tight, a little higher line might help him.
Well, I think Kyle Busch was thinking the same thing we were thinking. He saw the opportunity to get by that 16 car down the back straightaway the last time, so he takes the lead. When they come back around, it'll be 7 laps to go. Okay, who's made a nice recovery, because he made a bunch of pit stops under that last caution. He was actually involved in that crash. Is Clint Bowyer in that 33 car, was all the way at the back of the field, and now he's worked his way back up to the top 10.
Well, Larry, that's a backup car, and I'm sure they had to probably tune on it a little bit.
Yeah, with no practice.
No practice.
Michael Waltrip, the 51,
whoa, Michael,
gets back into Regan.
Oh,
the 70.
No, for
oh, gosh, Regan
sake.
Smith, and around goes Michael. Hard hit into the infield barrier.
That is unbelievable.
One out off of 4.
It looked, well, we'll wait and see the replays.
I tell you, he got spun out,
yeah,
in the, he got, well, he says it's his fault. So good for, you know, we'll see what happened.
What I'm looking for here, Darrell, is did Michael get loose off the corner, get out of the throttle, and back up into Regan Smith here?
Here he is. He's, you can see Regan just, something happened to Michael's car. Regan just could not do anything. And boy, he and Jeff Gordon now, they've made contact with the outside wall. And Michael hits this inside retaining wall pretty hard right here. I'm glad they got the safer barriers there these days.
Now, guys, just remember, if any one of those four guys that has the four fastest speeds from Saturday races their way in, Michael Waltrip is the next car in line to get into 500.
Well, I don't know. I'd have to take a look at that again, but it almost looked like I might have been seeing things, and I'm not trying to make an excuse for my brother, but it looked like a left rear tire might have been soft on that car.
Now, there's the damage on the left front corner of Jeff Gordon's car.
Yeah, he brushed
the right side.
Yeah, he brushed the wall pretty hard with that right side, Gordon did. You can see there, we got quite a bit of damage.
Now, I think, like the Budweiser shootout the other night, we've been out there for about 20 laps on these tires. I think we will see pit stops. Maybe they'll go the route they went the other night. A lot of them went with just two right side tires.
Got to get tires. You're setting duck if you don't.
As Larry pointed out, Michael Waltrip is one of four drivers today with two chances to make the race. Either race their way in or fall back on their qualifying speed, depending on what happens. So Michael Waltrip's fate for Sunday is in the hand of others.
Jimmy Johnson stayed out, the 48 car.
Imagine Chad doing something like that.
Among the go-or-go-homers, Max Pappas stays out as well.
I tell you what, if I'm Max Pappas, I look up here and I see the 48 car, I go with him.
Matt?
The 13 was tight. They were talking about pitting for right sides, and Bootybarger said, stay out, stay out, stay out. To Nick Berger.
And Kyle Busch has pitted for two tires. Biffle just passed him as he left his pit stall. But looks like Kyle Busch got by him. Two tires on the outside for Busch, said the car was pushing.
We had a mixed bag of things there. We had two tires, we had four tires, and then as the note we made, we had a couple of three cars that actually stayed out.
Reed Sorensen rolled the dice, and he won't be the race leader. He'll be third in line.
Boy, Hendrick Motorsports has had a pretty tough go of it down here this week. Mark Martin's had a backup car, had to get out. Jimmy Johnson. Now Gordon's got damage.
Jimmy Johnson, Max Pappas, the leaders. Pappas trying to transfer into the 500. Coming down pit road, right there is the pit stall for the 32, and Reed Sorensen is by it. before he notices where it was.
We couldn't
figure out. Had to come back around and then make a stop.
Couldn't figure out what he was doing, and now we know. I think he just blew by his pit box, so he just went back out. Then he had to come back in, or he chose to come back in.
But he has four fresh tires.
Matt?
And Booty Barker simply told the 13 of Max Pappas, we've got five laps left. Just try to get to the bottom. Keep it to the bottom as quickly as you can.
And we're back under green.
And he just backed that lineup, that outside lineup, because he spun his tires, hot tires, pick up a lot of debris. He just spun the heck out of them, and that's going to hurt him. And Greg Biffle's not happy about it either.
Pappas is second. Todd Bodine is 13th. Joe Nemechek, 17th.
I think Reed Sorensen's problems just got worse. He is running real slow at the bottom of turn one and two in that 32 car. Look at Bowyer in that 33 car, four wide at one point down the back straightaway.
Does business pick up when we only have three or four laps to go here? It gets real serious.
You're fighting for the second row of the Daytona 500. Look at Biffle way on the outside. He's coming around the whole pack.
Yeah, he was real. You know, he was right on Pappas's rear bumper. Pappas didn't go. That backed him up, and that's a shame because Greg had a really fast car.
Oh, Jimmy Johnson comes down to slice across the nose of Clint Bowyer's 33.
Well, remember now, Johnson stayed out, so he doesn't have quite as good a tire as these other guys do. He's got his hands full.
Three to go.
And he's got Clint Bowyer in that 33 car all the way from last to second in just a little over 20 laps.
Todd Bodine, Max Pappas in the transfer spots. Michael McDowell coming with Joe Nemechek.
Oh, boy.
Ooh,
Pappas.
Made a little contact there.
Of course,
with Carl Edwards.
He stayed out too, and he doesn't have tires, and he's getting eaten up.
The player is at 55 car at the top of the racetrack there, Michael McDowell. That's the transfer spot right there, the 55 and the 13.
Count it done.
But right now, Todd Bodine in that 27 car, he is the highest running go-home car. You see him in the black car in the high side, and there goes McDowell to the bottom. He wants the lead of the go-homers.
I got to give a tip of hat to that 27 bunch. What a great job to get that car up there, competitive, and got a shot at getting in the Daytona 500.
And for the second time in the last few years, Kirk Shelmerdine has a chance to be the Cinderella story of this year's 500.
And what a great move to put Todd Bodine in the car and get it into the race if he can.
Whoops. Here comes Pappas on the bottom. There is Shelmerdine looking on.
Now guys, we're going to be seeing a white flag this time, one to go.
Uh-oh, Mark Martin just...
Mark's in trouble.
Something
Mark's got
Mark.
Problems. White flag.
That's all he needed to see, Larry. He's on the pole for the 500. Get out of town.
I think you're right. I think he felt like it might get a little crazy here on this lap, last lap, and Mark's usually pretty right.
This is going to be a crowded house. Here comes Harvick, right up the back bumper of Jimmy Johnson.
And there goes Kyle Busch in the 18 car. Jumped to the high side. He gets blocked. He goes back to the bottom.
Jimmy Johnson doing what a whale of a job he's doing on those tires. Stayed out.
I think Bowyer pushed Harvick right by him on the outside through three and four.
Teammates, two Chevys helping each other.
Hey, have you ever seen this movie before?
Here comes Harvick.
Don't count Jimmy Johnson
out. Jimmy Johnson's fighting back.
It's
not over yet.
Check
Greg
Ray in the air.
Jimmy Johnson. Johnson got it.
I mean,
by inch.
6/1000ths of a second.
That's what I said, an inch.
With no fresh tires on that race car.
Good call, Chad Knaus.
Unofficially for the transfer spot.
Where did it go? Why did it go over? I was still going.
How close do you want it?
Harvick tried to get that side draft off of him.
And he actually sucked Jimmy Johnson around. You can see the back of the car swing around just a tad, but he made it.
Wow.
What great camera work. What a finish right there.
There's the difference.
Instead of Harvick by inches, it's Johnson by inches. Now, further back at 14th, Michael McDowell. High side. Is Bodine got into the wall. Max Pappas makes the pass. Can he hold on for the last transfer spot? Bodine comes back on the outside but runs out of room. Max Pappas is in the Daytona 500.
Oh, you're talking about a happy guy. Wait till you interview him.
But I'm going to tell you what, guys. Michael McDowell in that 55 car unsponsored makes the Daytona 500.
Look at Booty Barker. It's Max Pappas' crew chief. Oh, cool hand Luke there.
Steve.
Mike, you'd have thought this 13 team just won the Daytona 500. Max Pappas gave all the credit to his spotter, Jason Jarrett. Jason coached him home, told him who he needed to pass and when, and this is an ecstatic race team.
Well, Jarrett, now there's a name that knows how to get to victory lane in the 500.
And you got to realize something. This team is a part of Todd Bodine. I mean, I saw Mike. Can't think of the crew chief that on the truck team.
Mike Hillman.
Yes. Thank you, Larry.
Okay.
I saw him in the pit there getting a big high five.
What's ironic about it, though, the two teams, the two cars that stayed out on their tires, one of them won the race, one of them raced into the race. Max Pappas, Booty Barker, Chad Knaus, and Jimmy Johnson.
Let's see what the 55 says about all this.
Michael McDowell.
Checkers, it's top. You're all clear. Clear all around.
Way to go, Biggie! Way to go!
Nice work! I knew we could do it! Good job! Good changes! Where is it? Daytona 500!
Now that's Phil Parsons' car.
That's right.
And
One of two. He and Randy Humphrey have entered here. Dave Blaney's in the other one. And the best thing for Michael McDowell is now he's got a new highlight reel.
Yeah, something.
Instead of that qualifying one from Texas that we kept showing.
Yeah.
You gotta love this format down here during Speed Weeks. That car was 50th fastest, 50th slowest, however you want to put it. As far as qualifying, he's going to race the 500.
Yeah. Pretty cool.
Jimmy Johnson's in Gatorade Victory Lane. Dick Bergren's there.
Well, congratulations. How do you do a thing like that in a backup car with no fresh tires?
The photographers are bummed that I didn't do anything more, but I don't have any of my crew guys here yet. I didn't feel like beating this thing up anymore, being a backup car and all, but it just shows we don't build bad race cars. So I'm very proud of everybody. Hendrick Motorsports, the shootout car was very fast today. The call that Chad made to stay out on tires really paid off. It wasn't easy to drive the car that loose. Those guys on new tires behind me had a lot of speed and a lot of energy pushing me. But the slow Chevrolet did it, man. I'm way stoked.
Your team is on the way, and this certainly was a team effort. Let's go to Matt Yoakum.
Absolutely. Thank you.
Dick, back at the hospital with two-time Daytona 500 champion Michael Waltrip. Now you are the biggest Scott Speed and Bobby Labonte fan here at the Speedway.
Yeah, the tire started shaking a couple laps before. I don't know if it blew out or just was giving up, but I went down in three and I couldn't make the turn. I let off and somebody got into me. But, you know, Matt, this place has been the highest of highs and the lowest of lows for me. And, you know, after winning it a couple times and losing a dear friend, this is minor. You just have to put it all in perspective and put on your big boy britches and march on.
All right, Michael. Michael Waltrip will be watching the next duel to see Burns.
Thank you, man.
Max Pappas celebrating an emotional win. Max, I see you're in tears. What does this moment mean to you?
I mean, it's like I thought we lost it. You know, I kind of messed up a restart, and he got into neutral, and they went by me, and you know, I just dig really hard. You know, I really wanted to make it. You know, I'm speechless, man. It's a big day. I'm so happy for me and for the Geico team, and we made it from our heart. I drove it as hard as I could in the last 4, 5, 6 laps, and I'm speechless.
Congratulations.
That's a big deal when wow. Max Pappas is speechless, I'm going to tell you.
What an awesome sight right there.
Yeah. Yeah. Look
Mark
at there.
Martin,
look at Mark.
How about that?
Way to go. Mark is such a sweet. I love Mark Martin.
Max Pappas may start from the last row and Martin from the first, but they're both in the Great American Race. One more dual race to go. Don't leave.
It's a day of two races, and race number one in the books, nothing fictitious about Jimmy Johnson. In a backup car, he goes to victory lane. Unofficial results for Gatorade Duel number one. There you see Jimmy Johnson, Kevin Harvick, so close. If you missed this finish, we're going to show it to you in a little bit, but it is simply incredible.
Unbelievable.
Unbelievable indeed. Clint Bowyer, there you see a good finish for him. But really, of course, the story, the guys who had to race their way in. You see the name Michael McDowell there. He was not in victory lane, but he was indeed a winner today. Steve Burns caught up with him.
Yeah.
Michael McDowell makes it in. Just the other day, you were looking for a spotter in the garage, and now you're in the Daytona 500.
Yeah, it's unreal. You know, just very fortunate. Thank God that I'm here to have this opportunity. And, you know, Phil Parsons, Randy Humphreys at Prism Motorsports for letting me do this. And everybody at Michael Walter Racing, they gave us a good car here to attempt. And, you know, just really exciting, you know, 4 or 5 laps there at the end, and got the pushes that we needed. And I knew we had a good car. We just lost track position there, and we made a last minute shocker change, and it was big. The car took off. So I feel like I won the Daytona 500, and just real excited to be here and racing on Sunday.
Good luck.
Thanks.
You see that smile there? That says it all. Michael McDowell and Max Pappas race their way in. Jimmy Johnson is the race winner in Gatorade Duel number one. But hey, that's just half the story. We have race number two still to come. It's the Gatorade Duel at Daytona on Speed. The Gatorade Duel at Daytona. There you see there's actually a celebration going on in Victory Lane because race number one is complete. If you missed it, well, let's get you caught up. This was race number one in the Gatorade Duel. Mark Martin, he's on the pole for the Daytona 500. He started this one and looked good early, Jeff.
He was, see right here, the 43 car going around what now is 18 car of Kyle Busch going into second place. But here's one of the early cautions for Jeff Burton. Loses the right front tire right there, takes the whole fender off, ends his day.
Wow, that tire just exploded. Hey, you mentioned A.J. Allmendinger. Yep. Was looking good. I say was because he slid right through his pit box there.
That's not where you belong.
Took him right out of it. Of course, what took Michael Waltrip right out of it. This was just detrimental. He was trying to race his way into the Daytona 500.
Had some tire trouble. Car had to check up. Somebody got the backup. Around he went. Kind of into his day. Now he's got to sit on the fence and wait to see what
That's
happens
right,
in the second race.
He could still get in.
But how about the final lap?
This finish was unbelievable. Ooh. This is the final lap. Jimmy Johnson stayed out. He was on old tires. And he was able to hold off Kevin Harvick. And that finish, so incredible. Johnson won by 6/1000ths of a second over Kevin Harvick.
Yeah. I'm telling you, you sitting here, you were holding your breath, and I was holding my breath.
What did I say? I said I almost peed my pants. You said I wasn't going to say that, but I really did.
Yeah, you did.
I mean, if you were not fired up to watch the Daytona 500 before that, you better be now.
Oh, and the thing is, right now, you saw a lot happen on that final lap, on that restart. The 32 car dropped out. The 5 car of Mark Martin, you saw him doing it basically a veteran move. That's a hornet's nest up there. I don't have to be there. I could lose a lot. He drops all the way out of the way, but Jimmy Johnson and Kevin Harvick. Now, I told you Harvick was going to be tough after winning the Budweiser shootout the other night, and here he come on that final lap, and he was getting ready to make a statement.
Well, you said Mark Martin had nothing to lose, but a lot of these guys did. We saw the emotion there a little earlier from guys like Max Pappas, Michael McDowell. They are in the Daytona 500. Mark Martin, one of the first ones to come over and congratulate Max Pappas.
Yeah, and that 5 car will start on the pole for the 500 coming this Sunday. So, you know, a good move on his part. Finishing where he did was not going to make his day any better.
Yeah, because going into this race, only 2 drivers knew exactly where they're starting for Sunday's Daytona 500.
As long as they didn't get crashed out.
That's right, and that's why Mark Martin, you talked about him laying back. We're going to talk a little bit more about his teammate, Dale Earnhardt Jr., will start on the pole for duel number two.
Again, Max Pappas and Michael McDowell. So, congratulations.
So exciting. And, of course, congratulations to Jimmy Johnson. He is our race winner, but we still have another race still to come, the Gatorade Duel at Daytona. Sunday on Speed before the Great American Race, we're there in Daytona with the ultimate pre-race show, NASCAR Race Day. There's no better place to get revved up for the Daytona 500. NASCAR Race Day, built by the Home Depot, live Sunday at 9 Eastern, only on Speed. Welcome back to the Gatorade Duel here on Speed, live from Daytona International Speedway. Okay, we're only half done. Jeff Hammond, race number one in the books. Jimmy Johnson the winner. What are we going to see in race number two?
Some more of the same. because, again, we know what's got to be done now. These guys know who's got to push what buttons. And I think because of guys like Casey Mears, and he's ran well here in the 500 before, he wants to make it back in. These guys are really going to get back up on the wheel because they know all of a sudden some options have just left.
Do you think they were as on the edge of their seats watching as we were in here?
I know they were. I mean, everybody doesn't realize that when that first race is going on, everybody in the second race, they're paying attention because they want to know where they need to come get tires. Jimmy Johnson and what the 13 car did really has, I think, really confused a lot of people as far as pit strategies. Up to that point, as Larry McReynolds was alluding to, hey, caution comes out. Let me get some tires. Whether it's this right sides or all four, you want to get tires for the cars. Well, not now. You may just elect to do what Jimmy Johnson did. So I think a lot more gambling may come into play during the course of this race.
They thought they had the answer. Answers now, we'll have to see.
Different answers.
Tony Stewart, let's see if he has the answers. He is with Dick Bergren.
Well, Tony Stewart has finished either first or second in half of the races he has won, these 150 milers. How about today? What did you see in that first race that could lead you to another good finish this afternoon?
Tires and Jimmy Johnson, Superman. You can take the tires off his car and he can get it done. So we just got to sit there and get the balance. I mean, obviously watching guys early in the race, keeping them in the draft was a big, big deal. So we just have to keep working on the balance all day for this off-steep Old Spice Chevy.
All right. Good luck this afternoon, Tony.
Well, Dale Earnhardt Jr., how important is this race in terms of winning the Daytona 500? What do you need to learn in these 60 laps?
Well, you know, you're going to find out how your car handles on a little bit longer run. And that's about it, really. I mean, obviously, we were able to watch the first race, and it looks like from fourth to fifth on back, the air's really, really dirty. It's hard to pass. So try to want to hold that track position if you can keep it. If you can keep your car in the top five, you kind of want to hold it there just because of the dirty air. But our Amp Energy National Guard Chevrolet was pretty good in the first practice. The second practice was a little bit of a mess with all the cautions, but we feel like we got a pretty good car.
Thank you, sir.
Thank you.
Dale Earnhardt Jr., one of the other drivers, along with Mark Martin, who knows where he will start on Sunday. You saw him talking there, and you saw Tony Stewart said exactly what you said. Tires, they watched that in race number one.
And again, it's going to come down to some strategy on pit road. Not making mistakes on pit road is another thing that's real important, but the way this thing kind of unfolds, your dance partners want to get toward the end, we may see a closer finish yet.
And impossible.
Never say never.
I know.
Never say never. And you don't believe me. Take a look
at
the
finish.
I know.
You mentioned the finish. Unbelievable. This was the finish between Jimmy Johnson and Kevin Harvick at the stripe, 6/1000ths of a second. Will we see that beat in duel number two? Anticipation is peaking. The Gatorade Duel on Speed next.
Woo! Good job, boys.
I told you, brother. Checkers are records today, babe.
Oh, way to go, baby! Way to go!
Woo-hoo! Nice work! I knew we could do it! I knew we could do it! Good job! Good changes! Where is it? Daytona 500!
Some of the sounds of duel number one, anticipation all the way to celebration.
Well, you made a comment when we came on the show to begin with. What's it going to be like? You know, we're going to have guys going to victory lane, and who are going to be the other winners? Well, you heard the difference between the guy who finished first and the guy who finished 14th. Not a lot of difference because they both are going to be in the Daytona 500, and that's how important it really is.
Multiple winners in these duel races. Well, we're finally catching our breath down here. Let's check in with the guys upstairs. Daryl, Larry, Mike.
Thanks, Krista. As great as you feel for Michael McDowell and Max Pappas, Todd Bodine, for Kirk Shelmerdine, they came within a car length of making the Daytona 500. Now they got to haul a wrecked race car back home. And we're going to have some more stories like this in race number two. Now, usually, Daryl, when the first race is kind of the calm one, the second one is Katie bar the door. But I'm really intrigued about this tires versus no tires dilemma that the teams find themselves in.
It really doesn't have anything to do with tires.
Okay. Amen.
Here's what it had to
do. I knew where it was going.
No, here's what it had to do with. Chad Knaus told Jimmy Johnson, you stay out. Now, if I'd have been in that car or mom, probably any other driver, I'd have been saying, are you crazy? Stay out. Everybody else is coming in. We can't stay out. Jimmy Johnson never said a word. He believes in what Chad tells him, and that's what makes him so good. You don't hear Jimmy Johnson arguing with Chad. Chad makes a call. Jimmy he follows through. And that's what makes them good.
Well, didn't you once tell Dale Earnhardt to stay out, senior? What did he tell you?
I'm in, and I'm not leaving until I get four. But I think on the other side of that, I think a totally different, same results, but different scenario. Booty Barker tells Max Pappas, stay out. Yeah. We're going to roll the dice. We're going to start at the front. We're going to try to keep this track position. And I think on that side of it, it was pure determination to make the Daytona 500 that kept Max Pappas on that wheel. He was sideways off turn four, but he knew he had to beat those other cars back to the line if he wanted to race Sunday.
One was a sure bet. The other was a gamble.
Well, you know, gamblers, they pay off here in Daytona. Oh, some do. Some don't. Reed Sorensen disappointed. Todd Bodine not going to make the race. And Michael Waltrip has to wait to see what happens, because if Scott Speed or Bobby Labonte races their way in the next race, Michael's in the 500. If they both race their way in, that'll move Mike Bliss in a backup car for –
Tommy Baldwin in the 500.
Gloom and despair and agony on me. That's my brother.
But of our top 35, what I did observe, and that was only half the field, we were a little concerned about the way the Hendrick cars raced in the Budweiser shootout. We knew they had speed, but what those guys did today, Mark Martin looked awfully good. Jeff Gordon was kind of hit and miss. They've still got some work to do before Sunday, but they're looking a lot better than they did in the shootout.
And what about Greg Biffle? Biffle ran at the front, took the lead easily, and...
Yeah. What that restart, what did him in? He got stuck behind Max Pappas. Max spun the tires right here on the restart, and Greg had to follow him all the way to 3 and 4 before he could finally get around him up on the outside. Lost so much track position. But he and David Reagan both, those Roush Fords are running. And I think we'll see a lot of big numbers out of them on Sunday.
Well, will we see another thrilling finish, or will this be mayhem and madness in the second Duel race today, Krista?
And that's what the Duel is all about. You just don't know. Drama and dreams. Whose dreams will still be alive? Whose will be shattered? Guys like Casey Mears have to race their way in. Elliot Sadler getting prepared. Gatorade Duel, race number 2, next on Speed. Back in Daytona, the Gatorade Duel on Speed. Drivers preparing for Gatorade Duel race number 2. Race number 1 in the books. You see the faces of the drivers strapping in to prepare for their chance, where they'll start in the Daytona 500. One of those drivers, one who has to race his way in, Matt Yoakum, caught up with Eric Almirola.
What an offseason for Phoenix Racing. They lost their sponsor, the team that won a race last year. They picked up stout young driver Eric Almirola to pilot the 09. You saw the first Duel. You saw different driver strategies. What's yours going to be? Because you've got to race your way in to the 500 as well.
Well, I think, first of all, it's make it to the checkered flag. You saw there with Michael. It's, you know, you can be in and you can be out. You can be back in. You can be back out. So it's going to be hectic, and you're going to have to race all 60 laps. And hopefully, when you come get the checkered flag, you're one of the top two. That's our goal. You know, we're gonna let her rip.
This young man pulling double duty, Truck Series, and hoping to earn a berth in the Great American Race.
Eric Almirola starts 22nd in Duel number 2. There you see the Tasmanian Devil helmets sitting atop the car. Very impressive. And something else that was impressive, some of those finishes in Duel number 1. Back here in our Speed studio, Jeff Hammond, Chris Devota, and we're joined by no one who's going to watch this race number 2 as intently as Michael Waltrip.
Yeah, we crashed there, and now I have to hope that Bobby or Scott Speed race their way in. And, you know, that's certainly something that's very possible, and we could be smiling when this race is over. But as Daytona can only do to someone, I think, we could be crying. It could be either one.
Well, let's take a look, Michael, at what happened to that 51 car. Because, again, you know, you were coming along, you're running really well, and you see him right there in the middle of the racetrack, and all of a sudden you had to look almost like you checked up.
Yeah, the right front tire, the thing just went into a bad skate. And it had started shaking a couple laps before that, and just couldn't get it the thing to handle anymore, and it's just so disappointing. I didn't want it. It was sliding so bad. I'd let off the gas and it finally stopped sliding, and then I got punted. So, just a bad break. I think maybe we had wore out that right front tire, because the last couple laps prior to that, it really started shaking.
Michael, you've talked about the weight now. I mean, it's been well documented. As a child, you'd come here and watch Daryl race. And since 1973, a Waltrip has been in the field. Daryl, yourself. What is this next hour, the next 60 laps going to be like for you?
It's nothing surprising, Krista. Like I said, Daytona always seems to toy with you. You know, I've had the most success ever here. I've been there with the trophy twice. Mm-hmm. And, of course, the loss of friends and just disappointing wrecks and races over the years. So this seems normal to me. I know that in about an hour I'm either going to be crying or I'm going to be cheering. Mm-hmm.
So this doesn't compare to a couple of years ago when you had to race your way in?
No, that week made my eyes all wrinkly. That made
that
me old.
Gray hair, that, isn't
that's gray hair. That 5-6 days around the whole 2007 qualifying issue, and then qualifying in the qualifying race, that was as hard as it gets, especially when you love some place, or you know, you love an event like I do this race. Jeff, you know, ever since I've been on this earth, I've been coming here to watch watch this race, and it means so much to me to be a part of it, because I honestly believe in my heart, if I'm a part of it, I can win it, and that's the motivation. That's why I want so badly to be in a little while.
So you're not going to be shameless as far as pulling for the other two drivers during the course of this race, or?
I've got agenda, and I'm going to try. I'd like to sit here with y'all and maybe try to cheer them on. You got a great view here.
Yeah, we do indeed. Of course, talking about Bobby Labonte, Scott Speed, those are the two drivers Michael Waltrip is going to be cheering for. If they can race their way in, that means Michael Waltrip.
Just one.
That's just all. Yeah, one. You don't need both. Only one. So that's who Michael Waltrip is going to be cheering for. Who will you be cheering for at home? Drivers like Tony Stewart. We heard from Eric Almirola, Juan Pablo Montoya, Dale Earnhardt Jr. getting set for their duel number two, the Gatorade Duel at Daytona. Let's go down trackside for duel number two's command.
And now, race fans, it's time for those most famous words in motorsports. Here to give the command, please welcome your Grand Marshal, Pro Bowl running back from the Jacksonville Jaguars, Maurice Jones-Drew.
Is everyone ready? Drivers, start your engines!
Drivers who've been sitting and waiting, watching duel number one. Now it's their turn. Duel number two, the Gatorade Duel on Speed, next.
My goal every year is to try to win a championship.
I'm really excited to get on the racetrack. You got a clean slate.
I've learned a lot, and I've got a lot to learn.
The whole season for Roush Fenway was disappointing.
We certainly set goals to win the championship.
Gotta wait and see how good you are.
That just fires the competition up that much more.
I really wanted our team back into a championship.
And we're gonna be a championship threat.
Set your goals lower than that, it seems silly. It's really tough, you know, it's really competitive out there.
Can't wait to get out there and see what we do have.
We made a lot of changes in the offseason to try to better our program.
I can't wait to be in victory lane.
Of course, hopefully we stay tuned to more wins to come.
Speed's presentation of the Gatorade Duel continues now. Are you in or are you out? Michael Waltrip still waiting for the answer to that question. It will come following duel number two. Let's go back upstairs. Mike, Larry, Daryl, let's do it all over again.
Krista, this is not just a 60-lap race. This is not just a practice session, even for Dale Jr., who has his front row spot for the 500. This determines where you're going to start on Sunday. As Larry said, pit selection is a part of that, but there's more. You're racing for more than pride here today, even if you're locked into the field.
Yeah, I agree with that, but yeah, I have a couple of three or four things I think we should watch here.
Okay.
Dale Jr.'s on the pole. Tony Stewart and he have always worked really well together. So are they going to get hooked up? You got the two Penske cars here with Brad Keselowski and Hornish. Are they going to work together? Michael has all three of his cars in this one race. So, brother, hold your breath, because you know these guys are—they're all out there racing each other hard today too. So a lot of scenarios that could really work out and see how they play out in this particular race.
And one of those scenarios is if there's a late race pit stop. Do you want tires or do you want track position?
Well, I still am going to stick to the fact that that you maybe want to come in there and get two right side tires. I know we had a guy that just won that first race, and we had a guy that transferred in by staying out. But I'm going to tell you what, they were hanging on by their fingernails, and they just drove that car with a lot of guts and determination. I still believe fresh tires are the way to go, and I think that's what Tony Stewart all but said in his interview.
There's only one Superman. And he just won that race.
He just won.
And don't tug on his cape either.
That's right.
Let's have a look at the Gatorade starting grid for duel race number two. Norm Benning starts out back along with Mike Wallace and Derek Cope in a backup car, so he goes to the rear. Michael McDowell made it in. His teammate Dave Blaney will try. Boris Said, Almirola, David Gilliland. Casey Mears had a strong car in practice. Elliott Sadler, Brian Vickers, Martin Truex. Robbie Gordon there in. Mike Bliss goes to the backup car. He had a good car for the 500, maybe not so much anymore. David Ruderman and Joey Logano also involved in crashes. They'll have to start out back. And up front, Dale Earnhardt Jr. and Juan Pablo Montoya. Golden Corral helps us look at cars who might race their way into the 500. One of those is Mike Bliss. We mentioned he's in a backup car. The car he had, Larry, looked certainly capable of racing in.
And he was very happy. Now, this car right here is a car that Tommy Baldwin raced in with Scott Riggs 1 year ago to make the Daytona 500.
And the other is Casey Mears, driving for Raymond Key. He looked very strong in practice.
Brand new race team, basically thrown together at the last moment. Doug Richard, the crew chief. They're getting engines from Earnhardt Childress over there. So they look pretty strong in practice. I think good enough to race their way in.
Thanks to Golden Corral. Help yourself to happiness.
Let's see if we can talk to the defending champion of the Daytona 500. Matt Kenseth, DW here in the Fox Sports booth, or Speed booth today. How you doing? And got a copy. Buddy, you're the defending champion of the Daytona 500, and I really have been impressed with the way the Roush cars have been running down here this weekend. How are you looking for this race today?
Thanks. I hope pretty good. All these guys on the Crown Royal team have done a great job this winter. Everybody at Roush looks like Greg's car was really fast here the last race, and Carl's was good Saturday. So hopefully it's pretty good. This car seemed to have a lot of speed, but as you can see by watching the last race here, handling is going to be really important. So we're going to work really hard on trying to get our car to handle good today and get a good test in here for the 500.
Well, good luck to you, buddy. And remember, you're the keeper of the 17, so go get them.
All right, thanks a lot. Appreciate it.
Aerial coverage today is brought to you by DirecTV. DirecTV, it'll change your life. Just call 1-800-DIRECTV. Let's get down to pit road. Matt Yocum.
Mike, Joey Logano's already had an interesting speed week. First, he couldn't quite find the handle, the feel he was looking for in his first Daytona 500 car. And then he was an innocent victim in a practice crash, forcing the team to a backup. He thinks that could be a good thing because this car actually responded a lot better to changes. He got a better feel for the car. He'll roll off ninth in the second duel. To Steve Burns.
Well, Matt, our buddy Larry Max always telling us to keep our eyes on the big picture. That's the case for the 83 team driver, Brian Vickers, a crew chief, Ryan Pemberton. Ryan says there's a very good chance the practice could be rained out tomorrow, so this could be their last and best opportunity to be aggressive and find out what that car is going to do for the Daytona 500. Dick Bergeron.
Juan Pablo Montoya, the Formula One and IndyCar star from Bogota, Colombia, was incredibly fast on Saturday night in the shootout. This is a different car, but the got exactly the same setup under it, and the crew and the driver think Montoya is going to win this race.
Speed's coverage of the Gatorade Duel at Daytona is brought to you by the Sponsifier. Visit toyotaracing.com starting tomorrow and enter your design. By Hershey's Milk and Milkshakes. Try a new way to indulge in Hershey's. And by Alien vs. Predator, 2010's biggest multi-species, multiplayer event. I think in that first duel race, it was Aliens vs. Predator for that final transfer spot. It was that hard fought.
Pretty exciting, I gotta tell you.
You know, Darrell, you mentioned Dale Earnhardt Jr. in two of the Penske cars, but one car we didn't mention, Kurt Busch in his two car. If there is a guy in this field that understands the draft about as good as anybody, and he's had a tough speed weeks with the Budweiser shootout, don't take your eye off that two car. And as you mentioned, his two teammates in the race with him.
Yeah, I think there's some interesting combinations here with the Penske cars and with Michael's cars. You know, three cars in each camp there. Interesting things could go on here. We see a bunch of cars fall into the back here. Joey Logano down on the bottom there.
That's all the backup cars.
And oh, by the way, Kurt Busch is on his third car of the week.
Yeah, he's lost them both right here in front of us, coming through the trial.
27 cars, 60 laps, 150 miles, and there you see the four cars that have to go to the rear based on practice crashes.
You know, we saw Joey Logano go to the back of the field, and this is the car that he drove to a top 10 finish in the Budweiser shootout. But this car actually had a lot of damage. I was talking to Greg Zipidelli. They sent this car back. This car did not make it back to Daytona until 3 a.m. yesterday morning, and basically less than 12 hours later, they were unloading it to get it ready for the duel race.
Wow. He will go from the back. How about stock car? What's your favorite stock car fantasy? We've got a great stock car fantasy racing game at speedfantasyracing.com, where you can play in your own group or join the overall game for cash prizes. Register now at speedfantasyracing.com. Log on and play.
Our little trackside group, we're going to be playing against the race day group that'll be playing against the NASCAR Camping World Truck Series. And we are plotting our three drivers for this week at Daytona.
I think it's a stacked deck. I mean, I think we got a huge advantage, don't you?
Well, you know, I want to indulge who our picks are, but I know those guys are watching and listening.
Yeah,
right
no,
now.
We can't say.
Can
no,
they pick the same
secret
drivers you can?
I don't know that I know the answer to that. Maybe we better pick them quick.
I think they can. But, you know, another thing that don't overlook in this race, I know it's they call them qualifying races, but you can win $50,000 in this race, a minimum.
Okay.
And so, you know, I mean, it's not like you're out there just riding around burning up gas and tires. You're trying to win a little cash to help pay the bills, too.
All right, here's the transfer situation. Scott Speed, number 82, lining up sixth. That silver car, he is the first transfer car. Bobby Labonte in the number 71, who will start back in 10th. Just peeking into view on the right side there. Bobby Labonte in red and black. He's the other transfer car right now. If either of them race their way in, it puts Michael Waltrip in the show because they won't have to fall back on their qualifying speed. If they both race their way in, now that opens the door for Mike Bliss to make the Daytona 500. Should Bliss, who's also in this race in the 36, not be able to race his way in.
But at least going into this race, so you know the guys that were in the first race, they know what they got. They know right. What how they get in if they're going to get in.
Everybody else has to race their way in. That's their only chance to make the 500. That includes Gilliland, Mears, Almirola, Benning, Blaney, Wallace, and Cope. Getting ready for the start of duel number two, green flag. We're racing at Daytona.
Tumba got him a nice jump on that start, Larry. Jones shot right out there. Kind of back and forth here, trying to figure out who's going to give him the best push.
He first jumped to the high side, then he jumped right back down to the bottom.
And that's a spotter thing. The spotter will tell you, move up, you got the push in that line. Move down, you got the push in that line. Push means you got help from behind.
Now, those cars that started out back due to backup cars have got to move quickly because there are some cars that don't have the speed of the front pack and they don't want to lose touch with the leaders. They've got to go now.
Well, we saw what happened to Greg Biffle on that restart when he got hung behind Max Pappas. Max couldn't go, and it caused Greg to go from a shot at winning to finishing, I don't know, 7th or 8th, whatever he did. Whoa! Man, that 17 car, he juked coming through the trial.
Riding with Martin Truex in 14th position.
Other than all the positions changing, it looks like they did when they took the green flag, two by two, all the way back through the field.
And we're talking about the 17 car juked around just a little bit. I've seen a couple of three cars that were just going along, look like in good shape. Man, he is wearing out 17. Kenseth is wearing out the back bumper, Junior, now.
And Scott Speed backs up behind Bobby Labonte out of the first transfer spot. You see the 82 stuck in the middle.
Yeah, he's in the sucker hole right now, and there's no place to go.
I was just going to say about, I've seen a couple of cars just be going along, look like in pretty good shape. Mike Bliss comes to mind, and the car just spun out all by itself.
Casey Mears is that white car right behind Truex, and he's moved himself up into a qualified spot.
And right before go home car, just after two laps, is Bobby Labonte in that 71 car. And of course, his biggest fan right now is down in the Hollywood Hotel, Michael Waltrip.
Ambrose to the inside. Kurt Busch down to block. And now stuck in the middle is Hornish.
Just don't like that middle. Nobody seemed to have been able to go anywhere when they get stuck in the middle except to the rear.
Yeah, in that first race, one time we saw three cars stuck in the middle that were able to recover. But when you're there by yourself, all he's waiting on right now is a spotter to finally say clear high or clear low.
Three of 60 laps complete. And you're right, Larry, Hornish is headed for the back.
Yep. He'll have to go to the back, regroup.
Through no fault of his own.
No, just got nobody's helping him. He's trying to force his way down and get in one of these lines, but so far that hadn't worked.
Rudiman to his inside in the 00. Now, up at the top of your screen on the ticker, If the position number is background is gray, they're locked in. Green, like Bobby Labonte, they're in a race in position, and they're going to make the 500 based on their finishing or running position. If that position number is yellow, that driver is outside of the positions where you need to be. You see Casey Mears, number 90, is in position to transfer. Scott Speed would make it on his qualifying speed. Mike Bliss has got to go, and so does Blaney and the rest of those cars.
Been watching the 71 car. Bobby Labonte started back in the 10th position, and he definitely is looking pretty racy right now early in the race. Has the Earnhardt Childress engines. In fact, this team did an alliance with Richard Childress Racing on cars, technology, and everything just recently.
Here comes Scott Speed. He just turned under Robbie Gordon there, coming off of turn four. Made a pretty nice pass.
Boy, they got Robbie Gordon. They had him in that seven car trapped to the high side, and he went from 10th to about 25th in about a fourth of a lap.
So now it's the middle row that moves, and Robbie Gordon in the seven on the outside to the back of the pack. Boris Said has taken his car to the garage area, but since that car has top 35 points from last year, he'll be in the Daytona 500.
And it looks to me like, you know, just based on what I've been seeing, you can get about 8 or 10 laps of this kind of racing. Then the tires seem to give up a little bit, and everybody has to calm down.
Boy, Montoya, he wants the lead, and what a power move by that 42 car. Did it with no help.
Larry, with the restrictor plate these cars have on them this year, that third turn, you can really get a head of steam down the back straightaway and sail it into the third turn.
Darrell, that move by Montoya was the closest I've seen here in years to the old Petty Pearson slingshot pass for the lead.
Yeah, or Cale Yarborough, an old Cale move. Yeah, I agree.
Lower right, you'll get another look at it. He gets a push from Keselowski, drops to the bottom, and slingshots Dale Jr.
About all that takes is maybe Jr. had to lift up just a skosh. Montoya held it wide open and was able to put the slide job on him.
But he did get a pretty good shove off in the corner from that 12 car of Keselowski.
That's going to be an interesting year for Keselowski in that 12 car. I'm really anxious to see how he does now that he's moved up to Cup.
Yeah, because he ran that car four races the end of last year, and it was pretty dismal. They've made some changes over there, though. Mike, a car on the move is Casey Mears in that 90 car. He's sitting up there just behind Bobby Labonte, just outside the top 10. The second highest running go or go home car. There you see him being pushed by Elliott Sadler. He wants to be the highest running go or go homer, but he's kind of boxed in behind Martin Truex Jr. right now.
Casey Kane there to the left of the screen in the 9 car is white. It's kind of hard to, it's not familiar like the familiar red number 9 car of Budweiser.
Ramirez is right now, he'll make the 500. He spent the last couple years with Richard Childress Racing. In fairness to Casey, last season, he was the fourth of the four Childress teams, and there were a lot of personnel changes throughout that team throughout the season.
He's had
so
more.
It was hard for him to gain traction and move up. So we'll see what he does here. This team only has funding for the first six races of the season.
He's had more crew chiefs in a short period of his short career than I had in my whole career. Every time you turn around, somebody, they're shuffling him around, putting him with somebody else.
Darrell, we talked about it. The Penske teammates kind of getting nose to tail. They're trying to get the lead away from Montoya.
Bumper to bumper down the back.
Bad Brad with Kurt Busch trying to beat Montoya back to the flag to complete 9 of 60 laps. And at 9 laps, it's going to be Keselowski to lead that lap. Dick?
The weather has changed dramatically, Mike. In about the last 45 minutes to an hour, the temperature has plummeted. It's time for the stocking hats, and it's time for the engines to have a little more horsepower.
Well, and that's going to also let this track get some grip that'll help the handling of these cars.
Engines love cold air. They make max power when it's nice and cool.
How about Sam Hornish in that 77 car? He got kicked all the way to the back of the pack just about 4 or 5 laps ago, and I watched him. He drove back up there without the help of a lot of people pushing.
That's what I told you. You go to the back and you start over. You get forced to the back, and then with a restrictor plate the way it is on the cars this year, you got some passing power.
He and Brian Vickers hooked up and just drove their way to the front. There's Vickers in the 83. Going for third place against Montoya's 42.
and I'm watching Dale Jr. He's outside there just now going into turn one. That car, it runs good for a few laps, and then it seems to fade. It just don't seem to be able to get it to handle well.
Different car, same way it was in the Budweiser shootout.
Earnhardt, though, is the only driver in this race with nothing to prove and nothing to gain. He will start the 500 Sunday from the front row.
He's got a lot to gain, Mike, because they've got to figure out what to make, how to get this car to handle better, or he's not going to be in a much of a factor.
Well, that's true, Darrell. You're absolutely right. Have a look at
it. And that's a lot of wheel. When you see a driver with his hands that far around on the steering wheel, turning that thing that far to the left, that tells you that thing is just not turning for him. He's got a lot of wheel in it. The car doesn't seem to be jumping around all that much. It just looks way, way tight.
Let's compare maybe Casey Kane to Dale Earnhardt Jr. with what you were talking
about.
I
mean, look at Casey. He just moves his hand from, you know, like 1 o'clock to high noon there. Dale Jr. is all the way around to 9 o'clock.
It's almost like they're running two different racetracks.
Yeah. And you can see, look, Casey is so, look how relaxed he is. He didn't even just drive him with one hand.
Could a lot of that be handled, but could it also be a different ratio steering box between what Casey has and what Junior has?
It can be a factor, but I think no matter what steering box you have, when you got that right hand all the way over the top of the left one, you got a lot of wheel in it.
Twelve complete, 48 laps to go in the second Gatorade Duel at Daytona on Speed. Brad Keselowski holding court. Teammate Kurt Busch trying to hang with him.
Boy, somebody lit a fire under that 88 car. He came up through there, passed a couple of cars. Now he's trying to wrestle second of place away from Kurt Busch there and maybe going to get pushed to the lead by Montoya.
He's got a good pusher with that 42 car.
Sure does.
Dick, how about Brad Keselowski?
Well, he just came on the radio, Mike, and said, loose, loose, loose.
I don't like the sound of that.
Well, guys, while this is going on up at the front, Mike Bliss in a backup car had to start tail end Charlie. He just went by Casey Mears in that 90 car. We got a long way to go. We got a pit stop. But now he just drove by Bobby Labonte. So now he's the top running go-home car in that 36 car.
Well, he had a really fast car, you know, and he got in trouble here yesterday. He was one of the guys I was talking about, just snapped out from under him, hit the wall off turn four and tore it up. But it looks like got a pretty nice backup car here, too.
That thing was a rocket just coming down the backstretch. Nice to the outside of Brian Vickers. Vickers drops down to the bottom once again. Steve?
Mike, he was as high as third. He likes his race car. He says the balance is really good. It's underneath me very well. I like it.
Talking about Brian Vickers, the 83.
Well, you know, Tommy Baldwin had a pretty good race car down here last year in the qualifying race.
And that's the very car.
Always hang on to those good ones.
Well, obviously, it may not be a fast race car, but it's a good race car. Boy, look at Kenseth all the way to the bottom. Three wide going into turn three with a 17.
Woo.
Casey Mears right with him, and they leave Ambrose in the middle in the 47.
Boy, Casey, his car jumped just a little loose on him, but he was able to make the pass. That 9 car has been jumping around a lot in practice, and it still is.
Riding with Casey Kane, fifth place. Matt, how about Marcus Ambrose?
Mike, he was just trying to get back down to the bottom, like you mentioned. He says the car is loose in. Overall, he says, not bad. He was hitting the ground a little bit, but he likes it so far as now the 9 goes to the sucker hole again.
And makes it. Slips up to the top in front of Hornish.
That Hornish has got a fast race car. he is bad fast.
It's a seesaw battle, though. You know, you get a run, and you're able to pass somebody, and then you lose a little. You got to get out of the throttle, and they pass you back. But that's what I love about this restrictor plate we got. That's why we can see these passes the way we do.
Now they're going to lap past Norm Benning, the black and silver car on the inside. Steve, how about Matt Kenseth? He's fought his way to third.
Mike, he is not happy with his race car, although he is in that third spot. He's saying it's loose getting in the corner and it's sliding the nose. It's not good.
You know, one of the things that I think most of the drivers have come to realize about this car and the way it drives, it's never going to be perfect. You just got to look at how much, am I better than everybody else? That's all you need to worry about. Bam.
little bump draft by Montoya.
And this year, and
look what it did. Sent Dale Jr. for a ride.
This year, the gloves are off. NASCAR has said bump drafting is no longer going to result in a penalty. It's the control is in the hands of the drivers.
Well, you know what? This racetrack doesn't allow you to do some of the things that they're able to get away with at Talladega. Here, you can't bump draft in the corners. You can do a little bit on the straightaways, but not. You just can't afford to do it here in the corners. The cars don't stick that well here.
You know what, guys? We were talking about Mike Bliss coming from the back of the field. How about Joey Logano in that 20 car right there? That's a backup car. It is the car he ran in the shootout, but he has worked his way into the top 10.
That orange car of Logano's is eighth. The other big rule change announced this morning at the drivers' meeting is that NASCAR will make multiple attempts to finish the race under green. We're familiar with the green-white checker finish. They will now, they've decided, make three attempts if necessary at a green-white checker, and the controlling factor will be they want the leader to take the white flag under green. If not, they'll put out the caution and try again. That's a new rule beginning right now in all three of NASCAR's top series. Dick Berggren.
Stewart has dropped to the back of the lead draft, Mike, and there is probably trouble under the hood. They are not sure exactly what it is, but Stewart not running well at all this afternoon.
Tony Stewart has won everything here but the Daytona 500. And will start, but perhaps toward the back, depending on what happens in these remaining 39 laps.
That's three pretty good ones there on the outside, the 17, the 88, and the 42. And then you got Casey Kane right there behind them. They're working pretty well together. Junior's given McKenzie a couple of good shots to try to get him up to the lead. And Montoya's back there laying on the bumper of the 88 car as well. So they're using a bump draft.
Well, this would be about the time that the handling issues are going to start showing up. We're a little over halfway through that fuel run. 22 laps. Again, the fuel run here is about 38 to 42 laps.
What's that 88? He came off of turn two over there. He was a good distance behind Matt Kenseth. But again, you can just run so fast down that back straightaway now. The closing rate on the car now with this plate is so much higher than what it's been in the past.
You know, guys, watching our transfer spot, David Gilliland driving for Beth Ann Morgenthau, Tony Morgenthau in that 49 car. He has now moved into the second highest running go or go home car. He just drove by Casey Mears in that 90.
Got Larry the cable guy on the hood. Larry the cable guy is a native of Sanford, Florida, not far from here.
Just down the road.
Yeah.
We got Larry the weather guy.
Brad Keselowski may lose the lead to Matt Kenseth here. Maybe not.
Boy, he's got Penske Dodges all over the place around him, behind him.
Three of the first four spots to Rogers Penske team. Interesting story.
Whoa.
Interesting tale on that 12 car. It carries the name of Penske. Roger has a sponsorship deal with what was Altel. But when that company was bought by Verizon Wireless, they still have the sponsorship. They're running those colors, but they can't run the name on the car. So it reads Penske.
And what will be interesting with that 17 car of Matt Kenseth, we heard him talking about he was not happy with his car, how the car drives out front now with all the nose, with all the air pushing down on the nose of the car.
I think Matt Kenseth, if I were his crew chief, you got to be a salesman with Matt. Matt, the car's not that bad. Your lap times are good. Get after it.
36 laps to go in the second Gatorade Duel. The caution is just waved at Daytona. David Gilliland came off the corner and got a big smack of the wall, went down to the other end, and spun a turn four.
Same come off of turn two right here, and he's going to push out, push out, push out, and bam.
A hard lick right there.
And then just now.
Yeah, Ix has off of turn four.
Turn four. Logano gets under him. And has to jump on the brake as Gilliland takes a ride right across the bow of Scott Speed.
That's about as close as it gets right there. A lot of damage to the right side of that 49 car, but I would say when the boys get back around here, that pit road's going to be a busy place.
I think Larry the Cable Guy said, that ain't funny right there, and I don't care who you are.
Because definitely David Gilliland, he had his sights set on Mike Bliss about the time that happened.
So now the cars in the transfer spots are Bliss and Bobby Labonte, ahead of Scott Speed and Casey Mears.
We saw the mistake that A.J. Allmendinger made in that first race as far as pit stops. A lot of these guys making their first pit stop of the season, the guys that were not in the Budweiser shootout the other night. Keselowski was not in the shootout. He's all the way out in the grass.
Matt?
Kenny Francis reminded Casey, be careful on pit road. It is a little slippery. They're going to make an air pressure change on both left side tires and chassis adjustment. The car just way too free at entry. Steve?
Well, Matt Dalenar Jr. says, check my fenders. There's a lot of damage to my cars. It's very aggressive out there. Matt Kent is saying, the car is better than I thought. Help me on entry. Tighten me up, Dick.
Juan Pablo Montoya's car is just a little bit tight. It has been fast. They are adjusting air pressure. That's all. No wrenches went into the chassis.
Matt Kenseth leads everybody off pit road. The Killer Bees did it again.
There's a big surprise.
And they may have been doing some work on that right front of that 88 car, but they were there for a long time, and he's actually still sitting in his pit box. He finally pulls away, but he'll be about the last car off.
So let's see what happened to first to Steve.
Mike, Lance McGrew just telling the crew, check the left rear quarter panel, left rear. They didn't want to take off. They didn't want to pull on the fenders, but they wanted to make sure that clearances were okay. But there is some body damage to that 88.
Looks like a little on the right side, too.
Well, entering pit road, let's see if Brad Keselowski was shoved off the pavement to the far side of the commit cone or not.
Well, that's his teammate.
Ooh, locks it up.
Yeah. Cut off the brake.
And that cone right there is significant. It's not just sitting there for looks. That's the commitment cone, and he will have the commitment cone violation, so he will have to go to the rear of the field.
Here it is again. Boy, Darrell, doesn't matter if you're on ice or pavement. When the brakes lock up, it's hard to steer that thing.
It'd be hard to get out of that situation.
Casey Kane was right behind Keselowski.
Oh, look, what he did was he speeded up right there trying to get up, maybe even alongside of Sam Hornets in the 77, and no place to go out in the grass.
Which, honestly, you're supposed to be single file. You're not supposed to be running side by side coming on the pit road.
Not a good move.
Rookie mistake?
Yeah, I'd say so. Of course, you know, he's certainly has all kind of experience in the Nationwide Series. It's not like he's never been here before, but he's such an aggressive driver, and that proves it. He's aggressive everywhere.
Get an exclusive Speed Trackside Tavern ticket package to the Daytona 500 for only $99. You'll have a pre-race meeting with Speed personalities, enjoy food, beverage, and live entertainment, plus a seat on the Daytona Superstretch. Go to SteveTV.com and click on keyword promo for details. Steve?
I really appreciate what Mike, one of the tire specialists at Hendrick Motorsports, Lisa Smokestad, looking at the set of tires that just came off Dale Jr.'s car. Lance McGrew just told Dale there's chunks out of the right front tire where the fender was beaten on it. So they do have issues with that body for Dale Earnhardt Jr.
And that certainly very well probably was where his handling woes were coming from.
And when you take tires off of a race car, you see the chunks out of the tire right there where it was rubbing on the fender or whatever that was. When these tires are the lifeline of that race car. They take those off, and what she's doing is she's cleaning that tire off to get all the excess rubber off of where it came down pit road so they can measure the wear inside, middle, and out. And that tells them a lot about that race car, front to rear, air pressure buildup. That's the vital signs of that race car.
And that was a good, solid 27-lap run without any cautions to break it up.
So Bobby Labonte and Scott Speed are in the transfer positions right now. Aerial coverage today brought to you by DirecTV. It'll change your life. Call 1-800-DIRECTV.
Now, a little interesting scenario setting up here now with the trouble that Dale Jr. had in the pits and Keselowski's problem getting in the pits. The former boss and former driver are going to hook up here near the back of the field. They might be kind of fun to watch as they come to the front.
Getting ready for green, Kenseth. Montoya, Kurt Busch, Casey Kane, Brian Vickers, the front five, Labonte and Speed in the transfer spots.
That shot of Joey Logano. I just keep thinking about back last year when he looked like he had the deer in the headlight look. And then this time down here, he's relaxed, a very, very different attitude about the whole thing.
Now, with that pit stop there coming right at the halfway point, these guys, unless we get a caution, should be set to the end of the race.
And Larry, I guess it's because, and I think it's because I've been in both situations, the guys that watch the first race always seem to have a little bit cleaner second race.
Whoops. Montoya. Whoa, there's just got shot back out of the middle.
He's flying. He's going backward like it could be a tire, but it could just be low air pressure, too. Sometimes the cars are really evil for a couple of laps when the pressures are low.
But he's definitely stuck in the middle. He's hunting the back of the pack right now.
That's when the old crew chief comes on and says, just hang on to her. It'll come to you. Yeah, but it might be a little late. Might be a little late when it does.
The 09 Almirola and Keselowski working on the 42. And up front, Kurt Busch wants the lead.
Kurt Busch is a great restrictor plate racer. I think, I'm not sure if it's been the last three or four races, but he's accumulated more points on restrictor plate tracks than anybody else.
Everything but a restrictor plate win.
No wins, but a lot of points.
All right, let's give you the sounds of speed as we come by to complete 32 laps, 28 to go. Let's update you on the transfer positions. Bobby Labonte, 71, Scott Speed, 82, are in those transfer spots ahead of Casey Mears in the 90. If Labonte and Speed both transfer, then Michael Waltrip and Mike Bliss will make the field based on their qualifying speeds.
Well, Dale Earnhardt Jr. is not making his way back to the front. You can see him well behind the pack, but a car that is, because remember, they just had the restart of this race about three laps ago. Brad Keselowski in that 12 car has almost made it back to the top 10.
And Larry, when I looked at Junior's car leaving pit road, the right rear quarter panel is all bulged out. And I think back to Charlotte and Juan Montoya. He got hit in the rear on a restart, and it blew the left rear or the right rear quarter panel out, and that car wouldn't run out. It wouldn't run a lick. And I think Junior's experiencing some of that same problem with that car.
Here he comes trailing the pack. He's got a little bit of a parachute going there on the right rear.
It just seems like that right side of Steve really has messed him up.
Darrell, they have damaged the three of their four corners. It's hitting on the left side right now. They have contemplated parking the car, but Junior said there's a lot of grip out there right now. Let me just go back out and feel the racetrack. But they have contemplated taking it to the garage before it gets really torn up.
Go Casey Mears in that number 90. He just shot up the middle. to put himself into the Daytona 500 if he can stay there.
And then Mike Bliss went by Bobby Labonte as well in that 36 car. So right now, Casey Mears and Mike Bliss in the 36 and the 90, that would be your two guys that would transfer.
And that means that then Bobby Labonte and Scott Speed would get into the race based on their qualifying time.
Mike, while we got a moment, I want to say hi to Tom Blackwell. Tom's the promoter over at Greenville Pickens Speedway, has been for 100 years, and Tom's not doing real well. And I talked to Jack Ingram last night at the Living Legends dinner, and he wanted to give a shout out to Tom. Tom, we wish you were down here with us. All of us have gone to that little racetrack and tested it one time or another, and Tom's a great promoter from the day.
Great racetrack in South Carolina. He runs it with an iron hand, doesn't he?
He sure does. Good man.
You see Keselowski in that 12 car, the black car on the high side. He's being pushed by David Ruderman. Remember, David Ruderman's in a backup car as well, but now Keselowski has made it back up to the seventh position.
Twenty-three laps to go as Kurt Busch leads Matt Kenseth, Brian Vickers, and Joey Logano. Speed's presentation of the Gatorade Duel at Daytona is presented by G2. Half the calories, all the G. And brought to you by Hershey's Milk and Milkshakes. Try a new way to indulge in Hershey's. And by the Sponsifier. Visit toyotaracing.com beginning tomorrow and enter your design. Kurt Busch is our leader. Change at the transfer spot with 19 to go. Scott Speed had moved up into the first transfer spot. Now he's been passed by Mike Bliss, and there are the two cars in position to transfer into the 500. Right behind him, the 90 of Casey Mears, the 71 of Bobby Labonte. Those four are going to race to make the race.
Can you believe they're all right there together?
Sure.
And what a battle they're having right now. They swap positions about every other lap.
Matt?
Mike, owner Raymond Key has put together an impressive list of employees on this team. Due to the economic issues, they picked up some great employees from EGR, Roush, Gibbs, Hendrick Motorsports. They picked up this number 90 car. It's a two-year-old DEI car. And Casey said this car just sucks up so well. They've got an Earnhardt Childress engine package. Working out the small details, but this young man almost won the 500 back in 2006, so he knows how to draft and draft well. And you see in the box a championship-winning crew chief calling the shots, Doug Richard.
He is just barely hanging on to that last qualified spot because Scott Speed and Bobby Labonte right behind him both won it.
You know, the best thing he's got going for him is what's under the hood, because that's makes you good down here, horsepower.
And I think the name of that team is very fitting for today, Keyed Up Motorsports.
Matt Kenseth just gave Casey Kane a boost. They are both in Fords. There's a Dodge and Toyota on the inside.
Casey Kane's got a good race car. He had a good race car here the other night in the Bud Shootout. That's one combination I think is if they could get the equipment and get things working a little bit better. Casey Kane and Kenny Francis is a good combination. Crew chief driver.
And whatever might have been wrong with the 14 Tony Stewart's car, it's not so wrong anymore.
I think that caution came at a perfect time for Darian Grubb and Tony Stewart, because you're right, Mike, they were in trouble before that caution, and here they are battling up there in the top five.
I really think it comes down to a mindset. Your car is not, it may not be right, but it's better than everybody else's, and you have to race it that way. Yeah, you might have to drive it a little different, or you might have to gas it, let out and get in the gas, use a brake, whatever. But nobody's perfect.
Steve, how about Matt Kenseth right now riding in fifth place?
He's having a bit of a handling issue, Mike, in that 17 car. He just told Drew Blickensderfer, I've got less grip at both ends. This car has gotten loose.
And his car was a handful earlier when he was back in the pack. When he got out front, seemed like he was a lot better, but you can see it right there. He's all over the racetrack right now, as we've got about 15 laps to go.
Tony Stewart up to third. Dick.
Well, they decided that the engine itself was okay, that they just hit a pocket of air, and that was starving the engine, but they have made multiple chassis adjustments on the last pit stop, so the car is running better and it's handling better.
If the nose, and with the shock package and everything you got, if the nose is puffing up in the air when you're in traffic, particularly behind another car, and it puffs up, it will make the engine run. It won't run right. It'll go in and out. And when you get the nose planted, then that air goes over the car like it's supposed to, and it makes the engine run better, or at least makes it feel better.
Martin Truex right behind Stewart, up to fourth place.
Boy, Truex has really made a nice move.
And I know well back behind this group right here, we've got six of our go or go home guys running. I mean, like you can throw a blanket over that group. You can see them right here. You've got Bliss, Mir, Speed, Bobby Labonte, Derek Copes back there in that 75 car.
Back on Truex there, you just remember his crew chief, Pat Trison, was Kurt Busch's crew chief in some of those restrictor plate races where they ran so well. So I'm pretty sure they got a nice package in that car.
You know, this has been a pretty tame race, but this is a pretty tight pack with 14 laps to go.
You know, Mike, you talked about Kurt Busch a while ago, that he's never won a restrictor plate race, but what a record he has. 36 plate races, that's points race at Daytona and Talladega, 15 top fives, 22 top tens. He's finished third in the Daytona 500 three times, including a couple of years ago when he pushed his teammate to the win.
Three wide with Truex in the middle.
Well, if he hangs on here, Larry, I guess the three times will be a charm for him, because this is his third car. He's had a lot of trouble down here, but maybe they finally got that all behind him. That sounds like Tony.
That was Martin Truex saying it won't run when it's in the wind. He needs to draft off someone. Oh, here comes Brad way up high in the 12.
And Montoya's going to follow him in that 42 car, and they're going to put Paul Menard in that 98 right in the middle. 12 to go this time.
One thing about Brad, he's not the least bit bashful behind the wheel, is he?
No, he's not. And after starting in the back, you know, he's slowly but surely getting back up there. I think if I was going to work on my car, I'd work on it where it would really sail off into the third turn wide open. Because if you can catch somebody there, you can really sing. You can just go right by them.
Keselowski up to ninth. And the most interested onlooker, Michael Waltrip, visiting in the Hollywood Hotel. Because if Scott Speed or Bobby Labonte can race their way in, and Speed is in a transfer spot right now in the 82, that we'll put Michael in the 500 based on his qualifying time.
Yeah, because what we've got the top 18 cars running in one group, and at the back of that pack is Mir, Speed, Bobby Labonte, and Mike Bliss. That group has separated themselves from the group with Derek Cope and David Gilliland.
That's focus right there. Look at that. He's into that monitor.
If Speed and Labonte both race their way in, it opens the door for Mike Bliss to get in the race based on his qualifying speed.
Well, we're coming around this time with for 10 to go, so things are going to tighten up. If you're going to take a chance, it's going to be in the next 10 laps.
And there you see Tony Stewart at 14. He moved to the top of the racetrack, and I like the guy he's got pushing him, because I'm telling you, that car is a strong race car, that 77 car.
It really is. And actually, Sam does a pretty nice job on these restrictor plate races. He's had some good runs down here.
Darrell, I'm a little relieved to see this pack string out just a little bit from the way it was three laps ago packed together.
I think that'll just only be momentarily. I think they're probably going to get it all bunched back up here pretty quickly.
Great shots from the DirecTV blimp. Here we come. It'll be 9 to go when they come back around.
And it keeps changing back there. Now Casey Mears, Mike Bliss, the top two running cars of our go or go homers. But they're all running there together.
What's fascinating is, if you're sitting at home watching this, it looks so easy. But this is like a really high speed chess match. Figuring out who to run with, when to make a pass, when to move, go high, go low. Car's not handling exactly like you wanted to. Got to compensate for that.
Now if those two cars, the 90 and the 36, race their way in, then that puts Labonte and Speed in on Speed. Michael goes home.
We're not going to know the answer to that question. until we get all the way back around here on the last lap.
That's right.
I'm feeling pretty confident about that.
I want to bring my crew chief buddy Jeff Hammond in. Jeff, we've got 9 laps to go, and as we said, we always like to be in the second race because we can learn from the first race. I think if we get a caution here in the next lap or two, pit road will be a very busy place, but maybe if we get inside those 5 laps, we'll probably see some guys stay out just like Johnson and Pappas did in the first race.
I think that's really going to be the drama that's going to be played out here. We know how intense it's going to be as far as these guys trying to race in as far as mirrors, bliss, and speed, but it could all come down to somebody making a pit call like Doug Richard if he elects to keep his car out and somebody else comes to pit road. And when you come to pit road, do you put 2 on or go to 4? Because as tight as it's been real hard to pass. And guys out front, they've been the strongest.
Boy, Norm Benning, as they were going by him down there in the middle of 1 and 2, really backed up that crowd right there, got them all wadded up.
Tell you who benefited, Bobby Labonte, the 71. He is right alongside Casey Mears in that white and blue number 90 for the transfer spot. And Mears holds it, but Labonte, that brought Labonte right back to them.
You know, one thing about this race versus that first one, these cars look like they're a little more stable to me. I don't know if it's because the temperature's falling down like Dick was talking earlier and the track's got a little more grip in it, but I'm not seeing the movement that I saw in that first race out of the cars.
It's cooled off considerably. That's what Dale Jr. said on the radio. The track has gotten really grippy.
Boy, Vickers in that 83 car, he's got his hands full, but he's up there battling for the lead with Kurt Busch, the 2. They get back around 6 to go.
And again, I don't want to keep harping on the big plate, but a car can do that now and not lose its momentum and keep on going, make a pass just like he did.
Vickers to the lead. Bliss and Mears still have the 2 transfer. No, here comes Labonte. Labonte takes the last transfer spot from Casey Mears.
And he'll slide up in front of him. And this right here would help Michael Walter because Bobby Labonte would transfer in by racing in.
6 laps to go. Morris just climbed the hill going between 1 and 2, almost like the car started to get a little bit away from him.
Boy, they're watching Bobby Labonte back there at the back of this pack down on the inside there. He held her wide open the last couple of laps, and he's moving up in a hurry. Caught right up to the back of David Rudeman there.
He's got a ways to go if he's going to get past Mike Bliss. Looks like Bliss is going to race his way in. Labonte needs to hold that spot. Oh, Vickers gets the wall, just kisses it.
He had been flirting with it.
Inside.
For the last 10 laps.
That's what happens to these cars as they get late in a run. You know, the handle starts to really go away. The tires are pretty hot and probably pretty worn. You've got to really watch yourself.
I tell you what, they'll have a tough time getting by that 14 car now with 5 laps to go. I believe they got that car driving good for Tony Stewart. And there's the battle right there. Mike Bliss, Casey Mears, Bobby Bonney, 36, 90, and 71. When they get back, 4 to go.
Boy, something happened to Bliss. He backed up right to Casey Mears.
Boom.
Who gives Rudiman a shot. Bliss might have had to get out of the throttle because after Vickers got up and into the fence.
I don't. 90 car's a pretty good piece, though. It's handling good. Got a good bit of steam on the hood, and I think he got a shot here.
There's Scott Speed in that 82 car, the silver car. He's becoming a player again.
4 cars racing for 2 spots. 4 laps to go.
Right now is right, you know, we've been out here on these tires now. It's, about 35 laps, I guess. These tires have got a lot of laps on them. They're probably pretty worn at this point.
Watch them coming off turn number 4, particularly Hornish and the 12.
Whoops.
Whoa.
Sideways Sam.
Yeah.
Sam got sideways, and then Keselowski and the 12 got sideways in the same place.
3 laps to go. Bliss, Mears, Labonte, and Speed for the 4 cars for the 2 transfer spots right there.
And it's a long way back to the other cars behind that group right there. That's the tail end of this pack.
Mears tries the middle. Nothing there.
I think one thing that's maybe backing these guys up a little bit is that 83 car. You know, after he got in the wall, looks like he's kind of got that outside bottled up.
Hornish drops down to the apron.
Hornish is in trouble. Yep. Yeah, something's wrong with him.
That car kept wanting to jump to the wall at turn four.
Yeah, bring it in there, bud, if it's that weak. No sense in doing anything extra here.
Good point.
It looked like the right front tire could have been soft on the tires. Car, it's hard to tell.
Tony Stewart brings it back to the line. Two laps to go. And it's still Mike Bliss and Casey Mears in the transfer spots, the 36 and the 90.
I believe Bobby Labonte is sitting there in a spot where he thinks he's got that 90 car set up. I really think he's got a car good enough to maybe get by him.
Well, Rudiman covered the low lane.
Boy, the 98. Yep. Boy, that really hurt Casey Mears right there. The 98 turned just sideways in front of him. And we got a battle for the lead, guys. Holy cow.
Casey Mears up at the front. Here comes Scott Speed for a transfer spot. He gets past Mears on the right side of the screen.
And this is all happening. They'll be coming back to the white flag next time by.
That happened because the 98 car got sideways down here in 1 and 2, and they all had to back up a little bit.
So now it's Bliss and Speed in the transfer spots. Can Casey Kane hold them off for one more lap?
I think, like you said, that 14 and that 2, if they could possibly get hooked up here. And here comes Matt Kenseth. Help is on the way, Smoke, if you just hang on to her.
And all Casey Kane in that 9 can do is just try to keep working back and forth between him. I think the low place is where he needs to be, as long as they don't get the run on the high side.
Looking back from the leader, Casey Kane.
Here comes this. Here comes 14 on the outside.
And he's going to get a shot from Montoya. Watch him through 3 and 4 on the high side here.
That's all it took right there, just that extra little boost.
That two Chevys hooked up.
Here we come.
Slingshotted Tony Stewart right alongside Casey Kane.
Looks like the first race, the man on the inside won the first one. Let's see what happens here.
All right, who's going to make the Daytona 500?
I believe Stewart. Now Kane's fighting back. It's Kane,
Kane
I believe.
Got it. Kane, Casey Kane. By about another inch.
First Daytona win of any kind for Casey Kane. And now we'll go back and look at the transfer spot run to the finish. Mike Bliss in the 36. It was Bliss, Speed, Mears, and Labonte to see who would get the final transfer spot.
Tommy Baldwin, the owner of that 36 car, 2 years in a row, they have raced their way in, and they did it with a backup car this year.
That's a little cha-ching.
And here it is. The 36 of Bliss by himself and Scott Speed in clean air. Speed makes the race, and that means that Michael Waltrip's qualifying speed will put him in the race on Sunday.
But I'm going to tell you what, guys, I cannot wait to this race on Sunday. The total distance between first and second of the two races combined, 2/100ths of a second.
Yep, tight. Good racing, good racing.
Woo! Unbelievable.
Here's the margin right here.
That's the way it's supposed to be right here. Look at that.
Yeah. Unbelievable.
I guarantee you, and Tony Stewart was in there waving his hand, telling Montoya to come on, give me a shot.
Casey Kane, the winner. Well, Michael Waltrip, we knew there would be some tears at the end of this race, but in your case, I guess they're tears of happiness.
They are. This place is crazy, man. Why did it have to be like that? But me and Scott Speed are friends, and I love him. I don't care what he does to his toenails.
hey, Michael, you're in TV. It made for some great TV, buddy.
at my sacrifice.
Yeah, right.
Hey, guys, I could help.
Guys, all I got to say right now is we shook hands afterwards. His palms are so sweaty. I was like, golly, what have you been doing?
But let me say something, guys. That racing is incredible. You don't know how hard it is for those guys to slip and slide at 185, 90 miles an hour side by side and race each other like they did. If anyone says that racing in Daytona ain't the best it's ever been, they don't know racing. That was the most incredible. Casey Kane winning on the last lap, the drama of the transfer spot.
Now look, just a second or two ago, just a second or two ago, he could hardly speak. And now he's in the Daytona 500, and he's all over it.
Well, I just want to tell Bobby Kennedy I love him. Those boys gave me a car I could qualify in on Saturday and got that behind us, got a time good enough to make the race. So the Napa car is going to make another run at him in Daytona, and I couldn't be happier. We got to work on our setup. I think we tore up a tire, but we'll work on it and get her tuned up, DW.
Yeah, that big puff we just felt is all a big sigh of relief from Sherrill's Ford all the way down here, because that's where Mom and everybody is.
Did you see the tears, Mike? Michael, television has got to be harder than driving.
Well, at least when you're driving, you can't see what you're doing in there. not right. I know we all know that, but I'm really not right right at the moment.
Congratulations, buddy.
Yeah. Yep. Thank you. We got Mac. We got old Max in, too.
That's all right. Let's go racing, buddy.
Casey Kane's in Gatorade victory lane, and so is Dick Berggren.
Welcome to Victory Lane in Daytona. Is there still more left in this hot rod for Sunday?
I think so. It wasn't real strong in the front there, but it was strong enough to hold those guys off. I had Kurt behind me. I was like, man, me and Kurt have worked together really well in the past on these types of tracks. So it was, I was hoping he would stick with me, and we ended up making it there and beating Smoke. So it was a great race. This whole U.S. Olympic Budweiser Ford team did an awesome job all day, all week. I mean, it's been a good week and a half so far.
Solid run in the shootout and a win here today. Steve?
This is our race motor, and I can't say enough, and I'm so proud to be here.
On the outside looking in, but this time you're in the Daytona 500 after tearing up a car in practice. Your first laps in this car were on the racetrack at the green flag.
Wow. That was a lot of fun. It's fun because we're sitting here today and we're in the Daytona 500 with this Wave Energy drink car. I was loose. Man, a couple times I thought I was done, but I can't say enough for these guys, Wave Energy drink and all Tommy Baldwin's guys. You know, this car shouldn't be here, but they worked hard as our race motor, and I can't say enough, and I'm so proud to be here.
Great run for Mike Bliss. And those disappointed include Casey Mears, who raced his heart out for 60 laps and just missed it by about a car length. But what a couple of incredible finishes. Jimmy Johnson on old tires holds off Mr. Where Did He Come From, Kevin Harvick, by the second closest margin of victory in Daytona history. And race number two just concluded, Casey Kane beating Tony Stewart to the flag.
Wow.
We'll be right back. The many faces of Michael Waltrip as he watched 60 laps unfold here at Daytona. As you sat and watched this race, did you have this kind of intensity? Did you have this kind of skin in the game? Did you have this kind of reaction at the finish? And did you shed tears of joy and relief? As Michael did. He's in the Daytona 500. Steve Burns.
Mike Joyce, so is Scott Speed. Your qualifying effort really helped, but talk about what you learned on that racetrack today.
We certainly learned a lot about what's going to be like in the 500 and what we can got to do to the car to improve it. You know, honestly, I think we expected to be a little bit better than we were. We were quite a bit tighter than we expected, so gives us a chance to go back and tune on the thing and make final preparations for the 500, which, you know, that's a big advantage, obviously.
Good luck Sunday, Scott.
Thanks.
Let's go to Matt Yoakum.
Steve, those final laps, Casey Mears was in the transfer spot, out of back in, out, and then the field got jumbled up in front of you. Describe those final few laps and then when you crossed the finish line.
Well, it looked like, obviously about a lap and a half to go. We had the momentum enough to where the guys behind us weren't going to catch us and we were going to be in the show. But I couldn't see who exactly was in front of the 98. But there up top, that guy got loose, the 98 got loose, and he started coming down the hill. When I checked up, the 71 got underneath me, and I really had to slow down, and then it just gave everybody behind us the momentum to get by. And it's just disappointing because we were in position to transfer, and I think if we could have got second practice, then we might have got the thing handling a little better. It was pretty tight, but I'm real proud of everybody. I mean, this deal was put together about a month ago, and Ramey Keyes dumped a bunch of his own money into this deal to come out and have some fun. Really wanted to make the show for him, and obviously it's the first time I've never been in Daytona since I've started, so. It's pretty disappointing, but we knew the situation that we were in when we came here. We tried as hard as we could. The car was a little tight. We were in position, and the cars didn't fall where we needed them to at the end.
All right, thanks, Casey.
Yeah, thank you.
That team could have used the $250,000 it pays to start the Daytona 500. And here's a look at the starting lineup for the Great American Race, the front row set last Saturday, and the winners of the Gatorade Duel will start from row two.
And Mike, what makes Daytona special? The last 3 years down here, one of the few places where we had last lap passes for the win. You think about the last 3 years, last lap passes to come to the finish line to see who won the Daytona 500. And today, two of the closest races we've seen here in years.
And I'm going to tell you what, Fords could be just what the doctor ordered for Richard Petty Motorsports, because Casey Kane, second in the Budweiser shootout, wins the race today. Elliott Sadler had a great run today, and we know how well Allmendinger ran until he had his issues in that first duel. So those guys are looking good.
Michael Waltrip will get the last spot based on his qualifying speed behind Joan Imacek and Bobby Labonte, who also got in. And here are the disappointed, those who will go home instead of going on to Sunday's Daytona 500 as the 43-car field is set.
You couldn't ask for two tighter finishes than this until we get to Sunday.
No, you know, I hate to say this, because every time you see my case, say this is going to be the best Daytona 500. But we knew coming down here with that bigger restrictor plate and the aero changes they made on the cars, everything else, we knew it was going to be close and tight and exciting. So far, so good.
I was going to say, you tip your hat to everybody. Obviously, the competitors, when you look at the two races we had today, but absolutely, you know, NASCAR, they didn't make no big adjustments. It was just tweaks over the offseason. But I think the big thing that's helping this racing, aside from a racetrack where you better have your car handling, is more power with that bigger restrictor plate. Only a 64-foot an inch, but that makes a huge difference.
So today, two races decided by thousandths of a second, and we're off to Sunday in the Daytona 500. We'll have more from Daytona as we continue our Gatorade Duel coverage on Speed.
The duel may be over, but the action on the track certainly is not. Still tonight on Speed, Truck Series qualifying, Sprint Cup practice tomorrow, the Camping World Truck Series race tomorrow night, and then Sprint Cup final practice Saturday, all to get ready for the big dance, the Daytona 500. Let's go ahead and take a look at highlights from duel race number two. Dale Earnhardt Jr. on the pole for this race. He will start on the outside of row one in the Daytona 500.
But Krista, not for long. The 42 car right there, Juan Pablo Montoya, he jumps to the inside and he jumps out front.
What a great move by Montoya. Meanwhile, look at this. That's David Gilliland, one of the guys who has to race his way in. He slaps the wall.
Yeah, three quarters of a lap later, Joey Logano gets in the 49 car, brings out the one and only caution, pretty much ending David Gilliland's opportunity to make the 500.
And look at how hard they are racing. This is up front, Jeff. Brian Vickers.
Final laps right there. Everybody's really going for it. Darrell Walker said, hey, when you come to Daytona, you want to win. You want to win something. Casey Kane right there at the last moment, he gets around the 14 car and wins the second duel.
I know, and we said there was no way that we would have a better finish in that duel than
I
we did in the first one.
I told you not to say that.
I know. And then these guys, I mean, they're doing it for us. They're making it look, Darrell talked about how it looks easy. Nothing easy about it, but it sure is exciting.
I'm telling you, it was exciting. It was exciting having Michael Waltrip
it
here.
Was.
I mean, you could feel the intensity. You could see the emotion. You could feel the anxiety.
What did I say after race one? I said race one almost made me pee my pants, and then race two, he made me cry.
Oh, I'm telling you, it was incredible. It really was. I mean, it's something else. But, you know, the way this whole day is played out, we've seen that emotion. We talked about the winners and everything like that. But let's take a quick look right here at the 20 car getting into the 49 car. He tries to save it.
And this is really what helped Michael out, because look at Scott Speed. Scott Speed has to race his way in for Michael to make it in.
That's the way it is. He crossed right in front of two guys, the 82 as well as the 90 car. When it's your day, it's your day.
Yeah, and it's all about emotion. That's what the Gatorade Duel is all about, because it's the highest of highs, as Michael talked about, the lowest of lows.
It's all about the 500.
It is.
2 months of preparation. All these teams right now working to get here, to have the opportunity, and you saw guys who really, I mean, the journeymen, the guys who were underfunded, having a chance to make the 500. It was incredible. I mean, the 27 car in the first race came that close. Today, the 90 car, Casey Mears, he had a chance, and just circumstances kept him out and moved Michael Waltrip into the 500. And I want to make sure we don't forget this. Six cars that are associated with MWR make the race today. I mean, that's incredible right there, including Michael Waltrip.
And the guys who now add their names to the list, it's a Max and three Mikes. Max Pappas, Mike Bliss, Michael McDowell, and Michael Waltrip.
That's it.
Such an emotional day. We called it the most dramatic day in racing, and we still have the Daytona 500 to go. We'll wrap things up from the Gatorade Duel on Speed next. We're back. The Gatorade Duel just wrapping up. Both races here at Daytona. Jimmy Johnson, race winner number one. There you see the winning car in duel number two, Casey Kane.
Well, the thing is right now, when you look at the starting lineup for the Daytona 500, you look at the first three rows, you got obviously Mark Martin and Dale Earnhardt Jr. on the front row, but right behind them, the 48 of Jimmy Johnson, Casey Kane, Kevin Harvick, and the 14 of Tony Stewart. Three people who have won the Daytona 500 and three that are looking for their first 500 victory. I'm telling you, if this is any kind of indication of what we're going to see come Sunday, I don't know if we can stand 500 miles of
this. The emotional roller coaster, the Daytona 500 live coverage on Fox begins at noon on Valentine's Day. The Duel, of course, it's a heartbreaker, hearts on fire. An American tradition is renewed as Speed Weeks continues in Daytona. The season starts here from the first practice to Victory Lane. Hershey's Milk and Milkshake Speed Weeks at Daytona coverage on Speed continues next with NASCAR Victory Lane, fueled by Sunoco. And there you see the winning car, as we said, Casey Kane. Determination meets destiny. Who will it be? Will it be a Casey Kane or a Jimmy Johnson today? Will it be our front row, Mark Martin, Dale Earnhardt Jr., or one of our heartbreak, heartache stories like Michael Waltrip? Could he win his third Daytona 500?